Hey, good afternoon. Welcome to USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 16. Salute to service. This is Andrew Bartman, the Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Please jump into the chat, just like friend of the program, Rich Moretta has done. Tell us where you are from. Tell us what level you coach. Tell us where you coach. Drop your email, drop your social handles in there. If you want to connect with anyone else via the chat, please do so. Any questions that you think of during the presentations, put those in the Q&A portion down at the bottom of your screen. We want that in the Q&A. We do not want that into the chat. The chat is just for connecting with other folks that are here today. Welcome to our friends who are live with us on Facebook. We've pushed this clinic live on Facebook as well. So we'll have some people in the actual clinic itself on Zoom. If you want credit towards your USA Baseball coaching certification attendance, you have to be in with us on the Zoom webinar using the password and registered on our system. Just like always, you can visit usabaseballshop.com and get 20% off of your order starting at 3 p.m. Eastern today for 24 hours by using the code CLINIC16. Clinic and the number 16 will get you 20% off your entire order at usabaseballshop.com. Visit usabdevelops.com for all of your developmental needs as a coach, as a parent, as a player. We've got a free mobile coach app for iPhone and Android. We've got a long-term athlete development plan that's got some easy-to-digest charts and graphs to let you know if your child or your players are on track as sanctioned by the national governing body of amateur baseball in the United States. We've got Fun at Bat, which is a way to bring bat and ball sports for free with an equipment kit and character-building books to elementary schools all around the country. That's a partnership with USA Baseball, MLB, and Franklin Sporting Goods, and just a ton of resources. There's free courses, on-demand courses for coaches, for parents, for anyone that wants to get better at the game. Check those out. There's a blog. There's Instagram posts every single day. We've got a ton of my favorite four-letter F-word, free, a ton of free resources for anyone that wants to check them out. Go to USABdevelops, that's with an S on the end, plural, USABdevelops.com at any time to check those out. I'll put my email and social handles into the chat as well. If I can do anything for you or your league, Andrew Bartman, director of coaching development at USA Baseball. Almost said player, director of coaching development at USA Baseball. Please let me do so. Okay, moving forward, we're going to kick off today here with a special coaches clinic. It is the week of July 4th. A lot of you are getting ready to enjoy a day off on Friday because of the freedom that we experience here in this country. We thought it'd be a great time to shine a light on those who get the players ready, the ones ready who choose to go into that line of service, no matter what the line of service is. So we have got coaches from the major service academies on today, the Army, the Military Academy, Navy, Naval Academy, Air Force Academy. We've got New Mexico Military Institute, and we have another special guest, Bryan Madsen, who is a Marine Corps veteran and a high school baseball coach at Arroyo Grande High School in California. So this is a very special clinic. We're happy to shine a light on all the hard work that these service academies do, both on the field and even more so off the field. And you college coaches that recruit the best of the best, not only the best players, but you recruit the best people of the best to come into your program. You got a harder job than most, and we appreciate you and we salute you for doing so. So I told Coach Parker from Army that he would get an extra couple minutes. I lied. He's going to get one extra minute. He's supposed to go on at 12:05. It's 12:04. We're going to kick it off. Logan Parker at the U.S. Military Academy is going to talk hitting. A little different today. We're going to go hitting, pitching, and then Q&A. We usually do three speakers, then Q&A. But hitting and pitching are getting the most questions for us. So let's dive in. I put the link into the chat where you can access the packet for today with these coaches' notes. So, Coach Parker, I'm going to give it to you before the clock strikes 12:05.
Hey guys, thanks for having me. Andrew, I appreciate the invitation. Coaches out there. Something out of this, if you're thinking that it's going to be mind-blowing and all these new phrases, technology, it's not. I'm a simple guy, a little background on myself. I'm born and raised in Odessa, Texas. A junior college guy. I went to New Mexico Junior College and played for Ray Bam, and then went from there to University of Cincinnati and was fortunate enough to get drafted out of there and play six.
Coach, we're losing your audio.
Professional baseball and then start my coaching career back at Odessa College in my hometown. Pardon?
So we're losing your audio there a little bit. You froze up. We lost your audio for a second, but I think you're back.
Okay. But basically just if it's going to be a combination of new school versus old school, but more just a mentality. And the PowerPoint that I'll share with you guys today is something that we share with our guys. and it's very transparent. And if anybody needs it or wants it, I'd be happy to share it moving forward. So without further ado, let's go ahead and Andrew, can you share that screen?
I just got it back to you. You should be able to do it right now.
Let's dive into this.
There you go. You're in a good place. You get presentation mode. You'll be ready to roll.
All right. We ready?
Yep. All good.
All right. Here, obviously, just the title page, but those that hit. It's pretty simple. Those that work at their craft, those that are invested in becoming better players, find a way to do so. So that's a sign, that's something that's used throughout our program, but it's also a sign that's on our indoor facility. As you walk in, it's a reminder. If you want to hit, then you apply yourself and put in the work. So move into Army West Point hitting. A team approach, so much about you, the entire team. How can we score more runs? How can we put pressure on the defense? Just help up offense to win the game. Too many guys are worried about the batting average or a slugging percentage or things like home run. What is a quality at bat? Everybody has a different opinion, but at the same time, I think if you go up there and you give yourself the chance to put a good swing on a pitch, then that's a quality at bat. You may hit it hard. You may move a runner. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. But a quality at bat to me is you gave yourself and your team a chance to be successful. Ultimately, move on to number three, be a competitor. At the end of the day, it's a one-on-one battle. It was described to me by Darren Bragg, was my A-ball hitting coach in Dayton, Ohio. And Darren Bragg said he's got this tattoo on his arm, and it's, if you didn't know what it was, you had to ask. It was kind of jumbled looking mess, but it was vines and it had some names in it. But it was the names of his three daughters. So when he was in the big leagues, he said every time he would slap his forearm as a constant reminder that the guy 60 feet, 6 inches away from me is trying to take food off my kid's plate. I've got to be successful. I've got to put in the work, and it's a battle. It's one-on-one. So too many times nowadays, I feel like people feel like strikeouts are okay. Like we can live with that. To me, in the college baseball game, not acceptable. Find a way to put a ball in play and put pressure on somebody, whether it be they got to field it and throw it, and the first baseman's got to catch it somewhere on the bag, all while we're trying to run a four flat or a 4-1 down the line. So ultimately, being a competitor, not giving away at bats, is very big in our program. Another thing I wrote down here, the plate everybody knows is 17 inches. How do we choose that? I focus more on 11. We're going to have to give up six of those. So for each hitter, it's different. For each at-bat, it's different. For each situation, it's different. So we're going to pick 11 of them. 11 inches, whatever that may be for that situation or that given hitter, and we're going to own those 11. So at the end of the day, I'm not worried so much about 17. With less than two strikes, I'm worried about owning 11 of them. And then I just put control chaos. Ultimately, that's our offensive mentality, and that's our mindset is if you throw, 11 fastballs, we're going to put good swings on 11 straight fastballs. Just absolute chaos. But in the Service Academy, we know what it looks and makes you think that it's something crazy. But realistically, it's very controlled and detail work. So control chaos is what that's about. The two strike, everybody, is a two strike approach. Is there such thing as two strike hitting? Yeah, I do think so. You have to work at it though. It has to be built into a practice plan. It has to be built into your routine work and your daily work. You have to take swings in a two strike approach. So for us, it's 2 inches off the knob. It's 2 inches up on the plate. And let me see that. The last one, I've lost it. and then two inches up in the box. So basically we're trying to take depth away from the changeup, and we're trying to take depth away from the slider. Okay, so the late movement on that pitch, we're trying to eliminate by just sliding up. I don't necessarily want you completely on top of the plate, just because I feel like your brain gets sped up with a fastball. And anytime you're closer to something, your brain speeds up, and I don't want our guys being sped up. So it's just slide adjustment. We're going to slide up 2 inches. Barrel awareness, key for me. As a hitting coach, as a recruiting guy, when I'm watching videos or I'm watching guys play, I can tell a good hitter, but in my opinion, on how much the barrel's moving, and if it is a trigger and he does have a move, does he quiet it down in order to deliver it all at the same time? So I put on the Microsoft Word thing, knowing where the weapon is when you go to deliver it. If the weapon's in the same spot every time, it gives you a chance to be a really good hitter. Now I've got some videos attached here that it'll show a little bit about what I'm talking about. So this first guy, Jacob Hurtubise, senior, just deferred his deployment with Trump's new policy and signed a free agent contract with the Cincinnati Reds. Elite level runner, the bat, still a kind of a work in progress, but you can see he's got a little trigger with just some movement at the top, and then he simplifies it as the ball's coming out of the machine. That's angled BP. It was their first day to do it. So he was kind of working through it. That's the smile that you get there. They're not used to it. Here is Rob Regine, a middle infielder. And you can just see kind of the late move and the late, like, barrel tilt, making it tough to hit. We say, even when we're coaching our infielders, late and hard don't play. So any late hard movement makes it really difficult in this game. So you can see Regine, he starts to kind of figure it out, but it's still late and hard, kind of in and out of the zone. The next, Andre Walden, a big freak athlete, but again, had similar kind of barrel tilt, never was really in the same position. Put a bunch of work in. Again, this was day one in the fall with our guys and individuals. So put a bunch of work in. It was one of our better guys before we got shut down. The next one is Anthony Jakeen, All-American third baseman, left-handed hitter, obviously, but a really good player, really good hitter, fierce competitor, angry guy. Like, he's the guy that goes 3-for-3 and lines out in his fourth at-bat, and then he's upset about it. So Jakeen's a great player, but again, just a simple, quiet barrel path, the ability to use all fields, the ability to stay in the middle and stay on changeups and breaking balls. The one knock on Jakeen, again, is just that he is so competitive. But I would rather have that than a guy who just gives things away. And then just showing our guys, Acuna, again, like, just notice the barrel path here and just how quiet it truly is. It's in a good position to hit, and it's consistent over and over and over again. So you want guys to hit for a high average. Again, in my opinion, it's the barrel needs to be in the same place when it's time to deliver it. And there's the game swing. A little late hard move there, but that guy's, he's elite with unbelievable hand speed. So, again, just the quiet nature of the barrel is what we were trying to get our guys to understand. There's so many things out there in social media and Twitter of just crazy movements with the hands and barrel and late moves, like our guy with Regine, that we're just trying to simplify to give us a chance to have success. Again, Pete Alonso, guy's a freak, but just notice how quiet the hands and barrel stay. There is some separation. As the front foot moves, the hands naturally walk away from his body, which creates the separation. He's not, in my opinion, he's not thinking about moving them back. They just naturally do it as the hands and feet kind of walk away. And he gets to foot strike and gets himself in a really good position. Easy effort. I put on this deal. You should be able to carry on a conversation after you get done with a round of BP. Too many times young amateur hitters come out of the cage and they're gassed after 5 or 6 swings. It shouldn't be that way. It should be more of a, and I'll just kind of let this video play. Can I tell? Let's go here. Okay, so basically, it's one of the best hitters in the game right now, in my opinion, and it's just easy. It's not max effort. It's not big muscles taking over. It's little muscles. It's hands, hips firing at the same time, and it's just nice and under control, and he repeats the swing. So, again, carry on a conversation, but also think about the elite-level guys in the fighting world, whether – we used to say boxing. Now boxing's kind of taken a back seat to UFC. But think about those guys when they're going to throw a punch or to do like their spinning kicks that they're doing. Those guys are nice and relaxed, and it's quick. It's just in and out, and it's a quick jab or it's a quick kick. There's nothing big, wind up. It's little muscles taking over to create the hand speed and quickness that you're looking for. Too many times guys try to swing with their chest and everything else and slowing them down. So we're trying to minimize that as well. Capitalize on opportunities and to reduce the margin of error. Okay, so what does that mean to our guys? When we break it down to its simplest form, you can read here, obviously the average major league hitter gets 550 at-bats per year. They give away one or two, it's not a big deal. The team leader, which was Jakeen, 2 years ago, obviously we were shut down, but 2 years ago he had 234 at-bats. We realized baseball is a game of failure. How can we control that for the margin of error? Big league hitters, and this is the separator for our guys at service academies and Division I baseball and as a combined collective unit, but big league hitters get to go to the cage. Like, that's what they do. They wake up, they lift, they eat. They stretch, they get treatment, they go to the cage, they continue to have a chance to work on their craft. Our guys don't have that. Our guys are getting an Ivy League education, so they're being pulled in a bunch of different directions. And then NCAA's time requirements that they put on our guys, you don't have all the time in the world to just go hit. And where I think the service academies are different is at a normal university, when you're not with your coach, you can go hit. You've got time to do that because you're not juggling a heavy course load. But our guys, it's different. They're taking elite level classes, and there's a bunch of time being put into their homework. So they've got to capitalize on the time that they do get at the field and be able to separate the student from the athlete. There's a lot of time being spent on the student. So when we get them, it's a matter of when they change out of their uniform, on the military side, when they come into the baseball locker room and they change out, that we try to implement, like, it's baseball time. It's go time for you. So, again, if we can minimize moving parts, we give ourselves a better chance to be successful / consistent. Again, go back to barrel awareness. Why do I think it's easier if the barrel's quiet? Again, it just gives us a chance to be more consistent. We don't have time at the college level. We don't have time to get into a funk. I don't like the word slump, but I do like the word funk because you can get out of a funk. So we don't have time to get into one, but we have time to bring it daily. So we're trying not to waste our time. We're going to maximize that. Working with a purpose to eliminate the funk. Okay, so a drill series that our guys are familiar with, and I've used this for every year, so 8 years of coaching, different drill series. Obviously, on the left, you have your tee and front toss, machine there on the right, things that you can do off the machine. Hands only for us is what I have bread and butters, right? Those are things that you're going to do on a daily basis. So you just turn your feet towards the pitcher, and it's nice and easy. Again, we are trying to work low in the cage, like low backspun line drives. I told our guys, like, if I could take the top of the cage off and get away with it without them hitting the math building, I would do that. But obviously we can't. So we're trying to work low in the cage. no stride. Again, you're just spread out almost like an Albert Pujols, just learning how the lower half and the hands can work together. You can still have some rhythm. Slow load, kind of like a Cunha setup. So we just start our hands out in front of us and we walk them back slow. When they get to the back, you get to go hit. Think about it for all my Texas guys and hunters, as you're pulling a bow and arrow back. Once you get to the back of the bow and arrow, you let it go. Same thing with the hands on the swing. High T, obviously trying to work above it, getting through that pitch. Progression is 5-5-5. So you spread your feet out uncomfortably wide for 5, and you don't move them. Your feet are in cement. Then you bring them back in. You get to the actual finish of the swing with the back foot turned, and then you walk the upper body back, and then you go and you take 5 that way. You go into 5 game swings. Lightsaber is just kind of a rhythm drill. Just hold it out in front of you. You drop it. You catch it. You hit it. Just for those guys that are kind of stiff. Waggles, kind of same thing. I know Coach Foster calls it Ty Cobb, but you're just hands nice and loose down at the bottom. Pull it back. Go hit it. Big leg kick, like a Justin Turner type leg kick. For those guys, again, that are stiff and kind of robotic, trying to make them more athletic. That's one that we throw in. They seem to enjoy it because those guys that are typical robots really enjoy picking their leg up and having a little fun with it. So that's one that they like to get. Reverse stride, guys that have a tendency to jump out on the front side and really leak the hips. Basically, your feet start close together, and you just step back to feel the weight stay on the backside. And almost like a Barry Bonds, Mo Vaughn type, sit and spin type move for the guys that are too linear and get jumpy on the front side. I'll move over to the machine real quick because I'm not sure if there's one after the reverse drive, but velo on the machine, anything you can do to replicate high velocity, like that challenges guys. Tees and front toss is somewhat easy, but we challenge our guys with velo. Wipe out breaking balls. I don't want a lollipop breaking ball. That one's easy. That's a feel good. Don't like that one. Two machines where you set one up a little higher than the other, fastball, breaking ball mix. We will go pull side angle just to get the top hand really working. And then we go good gap angle. That's just offset on the sides of the mounds. Three plate fastball where one's backed up simulating 82, 85. Then you scoot up to your regular plate and it's 85, 87. And then you scoot up to the front one, it's 93, 94. So just trying to do those. And then the three-plate breaking ball with the hack attacks focuses you to hit strikes and always be in yes, yes, yes mode until you take it, and then there's your no. Here's one more. Walkthroughs, like a Frank Thomas drill, just to, again, get guys off of the backside that have a tendency to sit and spin. Jeter, top, same thing. Guys that leak forward, tee in the middle of your chest, deep point of contact. And trying to keep that ball in the middle of the field. Do what the game asks you to do. Again, it's a team environment. It's a team goal. The game may ask me to take a walk, to get hit by a pitch, whether it be with two strikes. A dirt ball read. Guys at first base, we're huge on base running. It's a matter of taking that extra base. So dirt ball reads, we drill them, we work on them daily. So in the game, it should be second nature. A backside ground ball, that's giving yourself up for the betterment of the team. You got a runner on second. We all know what that is. But being able to do that, being able to handle the bat in those situations, know what kind of pitch you're looking for, and be able to handle the bat to get the backside ground ball. Sack fly, where we actually want to work underneath the baseball to drive in that run. Sack bunt, huge for us. Again, pressure on the defense, a lot of moving parts here. A lot of things have to happen in order to throw you out. A drag bunt, clearly. That's a momentum play for us. If the defense is on their heels, it could be right after a double. Third baseman's kind of looking around, and you go drag bunt. So, again, momentum play for us. And then the last slide, I made it right underneath my 20 minutes with the stopwatch here. But success comes to those who are aggressive in their pursuit and have a process and are resilient. That's the biggest thing that academy guys have, and speaking at least for our guys, is they have to get up and go. They can get knocked down, whether it be with a test or with something in the classroom, and they have the resiliency to be able to shake it off. So I commend our guys for that. I respect them. I love them. And fortunate enough to get to coach them on a daily basis. Andrew, that's all I got, Bubba.
Great stuff, Coach Hart. Did you really sit there like the coach cliche? Did you have your stopwatch out while you were doing this?
Unfortunately, I did. My phone, my six-year-old's got my phone.
I feel that. I totally understand how that is.
Yeah. Six-year-old's got the phone and Netflix is going on at my in-laws. So, yeah, she's got it.
Dad needs 20 minutes of quiet time. Here's my phone. Yes.
Exactly.
I live that same life, brother. Good stuff. Great stuff, Coach Parker. Coach Parker will be back in our Q&A here in about 20 minutes after Coach, or 30 minutes when Coach Applegate gets done. So make sure you're putting those questions in the Q&A. Do not put them in the chat. Q&A is empty right now. I know you're just absorbing everything as an attendee. Let it marinate for a little bit and pop some questions in there. And go ahead, ask these guys how it relates to youth baseball. Ask them how it relates to your level that you coach. There's a lot of things that translate, okay? There's not that much teaching difference from the different levels of baseball. So let's get the questions in the Q&A. While, man, this is interesting. We got the coach at Navy, the pitching coach at Navy, listening to how Army's hitters attack every day. And now I'm sure the hitting coach at Army is going to stay on and listen about what the pitching guys at Navy do, right?
Yeah.
There's got to be some crossover there. So it's my pleasure now to introduce – I'm not going to take too much of his time. Bobby Applegate, pitching coach at the United States Naval Academy. Bobby, let's take us through the life of a Navy pitcher, my friend.
Great. Andrew, thanks for having me. This is a great honor to be with you guys today, and obviously a salute to service is fantastic, and I appreciate all the coaches that are going to be on today. So,
hey, Bobby, can you bump your volume up just a couple notches, please?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is that better?
Yep, plenty good.
Okay, thank you. Well, first of all, just a little background on myself. This is my sixth year, just finished my sixth year at the Naval Academy. And I'd actually spent 5 years at the Air Force Academy from 98 to 03. So I've gotten over 11 years of the opportunity to serve or work at the service academies. It's a unique, unique place. And the Naval Academy is an amazing place, you know, just for being a student athlete there, what they have to go through, you know, you're going to be a tired, tested, challenged individual, but you're going to be built up to be a leader of men and women that's going to ensure the safety of our country. And that's something that you have to remember every time you're coaching these guys up. And, you know, the opportunity for me is more than just baseball. You know, in my mind, it's an opportunity to develop character, and we get to use baseball as the lessons that we get to use on a daily basis. So I'm really, really excited to be at Navy. My philosophy, real quick, is really easy. We were going to compete. We're going to finish. If there's two words that I want people who watch us play to say is, hey, those guys compete. They compete their butts off. They get after it pretty hard, and they compete to the very end. They throw they're going to compete pitch to pitch all the way to the last pitch. So that's what I try to teach our guys every single day that we're at practice. We're going to compete. We're going to finish. And, you know, that takes a lot of focus. It takes a lot of energy. Make sure that those guys know that as soon as they engage on the practice field or on the game field, they're going to work as hard as they can to where they can complete their task. So to me, that's really, really important. That's usually what I want our guys walking away from. Now, obviously, there's a lot of things in between. You know, we're going to work on our balance. We're going to work on our direction. We're going to work on our extension. We're going to be quick to the plate. We're going to be down in the zone. We're going to do all those things. But realistically, those two words for me, compete and finish, is something that I want our players and our program to be known for when we go out and play some games. So just follow a little bit of my outline. Right now, I talked about developing the goals of the team, the staff, and the individual. You know, one of the neat things about being at the academy, we get to recruit players from all over the country. We're getting guys from California, Arizona, Texas, Georgia, Florida, and up into the Northeast. So everybody's got a little bit different philosophy, a little bit different style, and obviously they have the skill to be at the academy and do some things. But I think it's really important that we, you know, we set up some goals for us as a team, what we do as a staff, and then I'll talk to them individually. One of the easiest things that we'll talk about, and it's just the numbers don't lie, is just we'll talk about, you know, just winning certain counts. We'll talk about winning the 0-0 count, winning the 1-1 count, winning the first two of three pitches, winning the two strike count, and then overall just strike percentage. And that's a big part into our recruiting is how well guys throw strikes. We may not always get the best velocity guys, but I certainly want guys who are athletic who can compete in the strike zone. The number that we'll like to use is 63%. That's kind of our benchmark. So when you get into an 0-0 count, we want to make sure your guys are trying to win that count 63% of the time. We're in a 1-1 count, which is the biggest swing count in baseball. You know, if you go from 1-1 to a 2-1, that jumps up quite a bit. If you go from a 1-1 to a 1-2, I mean, all the hitters are hitting under 200. So for us, making sure that we can win that count 63% of the time or more, I think, is huge. And then sometimes, you know, it's not a failure if we throw our first pitch for a ball. You know, what we're trying to do is win the first two of three. So we're trying to get those guys to think that, hey, even though I might get behind, it doesn't mean I'm out of it. I still got a chance to compete, get to that 1-1, and then win that 2 of 3. And if I can get that to 63%, I got a chance to get to two strikes. The two-strike number for us is actually 75%, meaning that when we get to two strikes, I want that guy out 75% of the time. If that number starts to fall below, then we're going to really have to learn how to, you know, focus on finishing some guys off. But that's, again, just a benchmark of what we're trying to work for. And then just a basic strike percentage, we want to be 63% or higher. So how do we get to that? You know, we're going to start charting our bullpens. We're going to start really paying attention to that. We talk about it quite a bit. Anytime we start to inter squad, that'll be our benchmark. And I actually like to track all those numbers. And I post that every bullpen, and I post it after every game. So every week, our guys know exactly where they stand. You might have guys that have great strike percentage, but they're really struggling in the 1-1 count. So what it does, it allows us to have very specific things we're trying to work on a day-to-day basis. So from a team goal, that's what we talk about. As a staff goal, that's what we'll talk about. And individually, I'll pull guys off to the side and just kind of let them know what we're trying to get to. Obviously, they have some talent, or else, you know, we probably wouldn't recruit them. And so we'll talk to them individually just to develop that mindset and go. One of the things I put underneath that one is to be a good leader, you must learn how to be a good follower. That's something that we use here at the Academy. You know, we talk about being great leaders here at the Academy once you graduate. But when you're a freshman, we call them plebes here, they have to learn how to follow. And they're going to start learning the rules. They're going to start learning all the guidelines here that the Academy has to offer so that they can, you know, speak the same language, being the, you know, just making sure that they're doing everything they need to be doing and falling in line with everyone else. So rules and regulations are a big part. I think that's really important for our young guys is sometimes they want to come in and make an impact. But they got to give in a little bit to the leaders who've been working their way through and say, hey, man, this is how we go about our business right here. This is a great opportunity for you to learn. So as I give those goals, those numbered goals up front, at least the young guys know, you know, what's expected of them. And then the next line, I start talking about learning the volume, the workload, and the practice schedule. You got to assume that every high school pitcher has never worked through a college workload before. We're going to throw more than they've ever had. We're going to lift more. We're going to condition more. We're going to probably play in more games than they're used to. And they're going to get beat down. More importantly, you're a freshman at the Naval Academy. You're not going to sleep very much. You're going to take more classes than you ever did before. And everything's going to be a brand new challenge. So being from on top that they were in high school to starting all over as a freshman, you know, it's going to be a painstaking process. And so right then, that's when they really need to just kind of focus on following the order and making sure that they can be really good at organizing their time. I always felt like if we were ever going to change the name of the university, it'd be Time Management University, because that's really what they're trying to do. You got to learn how to put your attention into many, many things here at the Academy, and it's really important that those guys do that. Once they start learning the volume, the workload, I think things become a little bit easier. But it's the big, big challenge that our guys are working with. At that point, you know, I'm going to start developing the roles of our pitcher, and meaning starter versus reliever. You know, obviously every guy is coming out as a starter. You know, how do we script our staff? If you're recruiting 15 starters, who's going to be your reliever? Who's going to be your closer? How is that going to work? And for me, to be quite honest, I really try to pay attention into the way that we play catch. one of the unique things at the academy is we don't get to play a lot of summer baseball. So when guys are coming back in August, everybody's starting over from their military training in the summer. And so they're basically starting from the same place. And so we bring everybody back and start creating that workload and really start to pay attention to what they're capable of doing. We have a very specific throwing program that we put together. And every day I'm trying to work on, just controlling the flight of the ball, just going about their business and being very, very mindful and executing their throws. But at the same time, I'm paying attention to how does their arm bounce back from a day-to-day basis. Do they long toss? Is that one particular person going to need a little bit more time? Or is he really good the next day? And the guys who really bounce back, those guys end up being in my bullpen. When you're playing a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, sometimes doubleheader Saturdays and doubleheaders on Sundays, the guy who's got a really good arm but is only good, just once a week, that's really tough to kind of throw in your bullpen. So the guy who can really bounce back, who can throw that 20 to 30 pitches every single day and not lose a beat, that guy becomes very, very important in our program. And for us, trying to win games in that seventh, eighth, and ninth inning is huge. And making sure that we have good quality guys who can come in and do that are important. So I really pay attention to our catch play. Guys who do a good job of playing catch every single day with effort. And I really pay attention to those first 25 throws. Those guys end up moving into our bullpen. And then the guys who are really exceptional throwing strikes but might need a little bit more time, but are also strong enough to throw with a higher workload or volume of pitches, those guys got a chance to work into our starters. And I think that's a really important thing, starting to learn how to separate who your potential starters are, maybe some spot starters, long relievers, short relievers. And that's exactly what we try to do. So the first couple weeks, especially for the young guys, I give them their routine. They start going to work. And I try to pair our young guys with an older guy just so they can really, our mentorship program there with our older guys, get to work with the younger guys, and they get a chance to try to understand a little bit better. If I were to put two freshmen together, sometimes those guys will struggle. They'll spend more time looking around what's going on as opposed to getting their work done. So pairing an older guy with a younger guy is really huge for us. Gives that older guy an opportunity to create some leadership, and the younger guy just create some direction, which is huge. So that part is really, really important for us. As we start to get those first couple weeks down and we start to figure out, just who's going to be a starter, who's going to be a reliever, then within those groups, I actually try to rearrange the groups so that they're more similar. So meaning that the arm slots are similar. If I got a low three-quarter guy, I'm going to try to pair him up with a low three-quarter guy if they're both bullpen guys. If I got two starters a little more over the top or they're more three-quarter guys, then, hey, I'm going to try to pair those guys up together. I think it's really important that those guys have quality feedback, and I think being similar is important because if one guy's working on one thing, he's got a chance to mirror that guy. And I think feedback from your peer is really, really critical. I can say something as a coach, but I think once your teammate is saying something, I think it makes a little more sense. If you got a teammate who's saying, hey, listen, you're just kind of dropping your elbow on this particular pitch, it's going to mean something to him because he's seeing them every single day. He's seeing them for the amount of throws he's seeing every single day. So I think that's really important. And if you can create that dialogue with your throwing partner, I think that's really, really important. And hopefully that opens up more dialogue to go both ways. If we have quiet guys, you got a chance to open those guys up and teaches them a little more mindful of what's going on with their delivery. So mastering your routine, can you stay on task? That's one of the hardest things. Like I talked about, time management. Our guys have got a lot of things going on. From Bancroft Hall to the baseball field, we have a little bit of the Chesapeake that runs in that we got to walk over. It's probably about a good half mile to the baseball field. And so what I try to tell these guys is once they start to come over this bridge, they can actually see the baseball field. And at that point, I want those guys to start focusing on baseball. you know, they're taking 15 to 18 credit hours every semester, and they're fried. And they're going to baseball, which is a little more of their safe haven. But it's not an escape. What it is, hey, I want your focus. So when you start to go over that bridge, I want you to start seeing that baseball field, and I want you to start transitioning mentally from that midshipman student to the midshipman baseball player. So that mind switch is start happening. Once you get into the clubhouse and you go ahead and put your practice uniform on, I want you to stay in there. And until you're ready to go out and be that competitor on the field, I want you to stay in there until you're ready to accept that challenge. And once you get out of the clubhouse, hey, then it's all baseball. Okay, I don't want to carry on your conversations once you get out to the practice field. You know, you don't want to hear what's going on in English class or what's going on in your physics class. You know, I want to make sure that when we have you for that particular amount of time, I want it to be baseball. So leave all that stuff in the clubhouse. When you come out, be ready to go. And that's, again, can you stay on task? If we allow things to interrupt their focus, it will. So we really try to make sure that those guys do a good job with that. When we start jumping into our routines, and I think this is really, really critical. I think routines develop confidence. When these guys know what's expected of them every single day, they have an opportunity to just go right to work. I think when you go to practice and you don't always expect, a lot of guys are kind of staring at each other and saying, hey, what are we doing next? And I think that's wasted time. So really try to do a good job of putting that schedule of the week, whether it's their throwing program, bullpen program, or they're live, they know exactly what's expected of them a week in advance. And then they got a chance to, you know, arrange their week accordingly, you know, to how much effort they should throw, knowing that, hey, I got a bullpen tomorrow. Or, hey, I got a live game in 2 days. How hard do I want to go? How much should I back off? And then give them some ownership into how to train for those particular outings. So I think that's important. And once you develop that confidence, the confidence then increases your work difficulty, meaning as a freshman, I just really want you to focus on fastball command. Can you get the ball to the glove side? Can you get it extended? Can you get it to the arm side? And once they do a good job with that, then we'll start to give them a little more of a focus. Hey, we got to get quicker to the plate. Hey, we're going to have to pitch down in the zone a little bit more. And so as they start to get better with their confidence, then we can give them more work. And I think that sometimes we have a tendency to just kind of throw everything on their plate, go figure it out, and then they just are scrambling to make those adjustments. So trying to give them bits and pieces so that they can find that success. And then from that framework, try to tack on from there. And our throwing program, you get 15 minutes daily. You know, with that 15 minutes, I want them to be the best they can, you know. And I really want them to focus on, okay, you know what, this is leading up into my bullpen. This ability to throw daily is leading up to my game. And I want to make sure that I'm doing the best job I can with focus and execution. I don't get those throws back. And, you know, for us, we don't have a lot of time that we get to waste. I mean, our guys are going right from class. We have 2 hours of practice, and then we got to get them off and going or else they're going to miss dinner. So, you know, there's not a lot of pre-talk before practice. There's not a lot of post-talk going on after practice. So we got to be really diligent in what we're doing at practice. So you got your 15 minutes to go out there and really focus on your long toss. We want to do a good job with it. So we got to coach up the focus. When we start to get into our routine, into our throwing routine, one of the things that I'll start talking about is controlling the flight of the baseball. I want to make sure that our fingers are on top. And when you're throwing the ball on a line, I want to make sure that your fingers or the ball is going to at least land lower than you released it, making sure that we're controlling the flight. If the ball is sailing up to your partner, then we got to recognize that right away and make sure that we make an immediate adjustment. And that to me is just trying to be mindful of making a pitch-to-pitch adjustment, which I think is important. As we start to get into our long toss is just making sure that we can stay in our routine there. And what I mean by that is when we're at 60 feet, we're going to always try to throw with the leg lift. Anytime we get beyond 60 feet, we're going to work out of the stretch, and either you can do a step behind or you can do a shuffle step into your long toss. But we're going to focus on a routine where we get set every single time, So we're going to visualize what we're going to do. We're going to breathe what we're going to do, and then we're going to execute what we're going to do. So that way, every throw, they're getting a chance to go through a routine as if they were on the rubber. They're going to get set. They're going to see it. They're going to breathe it. They're going to execute it. And, you know, I just think by doing that, creating as many opportunities to focus on those skills become very, very important. Even if we're throwing the ball with a hump in it, I want you to be able to land that ball right on your partner. I don't want you to miss him by 10 feet. So again, it's just focused on the development, focused on the flight of the ball, and then we'll go from there. As we work it back in from long toss back to end, we're going to focus on command, meaning we just want to make sure we're still controlling the ball to the bottom half of the zone by working into a flat ground. And the flat ground becomes really, really critical for us. You know, it's a rhythm and timing. We start focusing on release point and extension. And what I like to do with our flat ground program, I actually like to get our catchers involved. So when we get done with that long toss, we'll bring in our catchers. Our guys will throw anywhere between 10 to 15 pitches. And it's just a flat ground with some downhill slope and just trying to hit certain spots, and they get a chance to focus on a couple pitches at each spot, moving from pitch to pitch. Now, the reason I get the catchers involved, if I don't have catchers, we try to throw to a pad, or we'll try to have the pitchers in there, but it's really difficult. And the reason I say it's difficult for the pitchers is, one, those guys are pitchers, not catchers. They're not very good at catching balls, and they get banged up a little bit. And so as a throwing partner, if you're throwing to your catcher who's down, you have a tendency to back off. Now your rhythm and timing's off. The release point might be off. You start to guide the ball as opposed to throw the baseball. And I want to be able to work on some of that rhythm and timing, really focus on, you know, a little bit of that extension on my release point. But when I have a pitcher down there, I don't do as good a job. And to be honest, pitchers, we want to work down. They have a tendency to hold their glove up, you know, just because they want to catch a ball that they can see. And so all of a sudden, now you're working to a higher target. So I try to get the catchers involved. If not, we try to get, you know, some pads that are down low that we can throw into. And that becomes really, really helpful for us. You know, and the great thing about the flat ground, by throwing to a shorter distance, you got to work a little bit harder to stay on top of the baseball to create that down angle. And to me, I think that really does a good job of emphasizing throwing the ball to the bottom half. And if you can spin a couple balls at a shorter distance, you got to work a little bit harder in that framework to really stay on time to work down, obviously with the changeup as well. But I think that's a really good thing from our throwing program to a long toss, where we create arm strength and bring it back down to a flat ground where you're focusing on command. And I think that's a good balance between the two. I just wanted to talk briefly about our bullpen routines. Our bullpen routine is first of all, I'm going to create a difference between a starter and reliever. With our starters, and we'll go through our throwing program at the beginning of practice where we'll go through a stretch. We'll get our long toss in. And at that point, I want our starters to jump right into their bullpen. And so at that point, those guys are going to start simulating a little bit of what pregame looks like. So they go through, you know, their court program, they go through their stretch program, they go through their long toss program, and then we're going to work into the bullpen, and then we're going to go through that. For our relievers, we actually will go through that long toss program, and then we'll jump into the rest of practice, and then I'll usually have those guys throw towards the end of practice. And what I want to do is try to simulate that time in between the long toss of game day and maybe coming in, you know, 2 hours later in the sixth, seventh, eighth inning, where they got to really stay focused and then come in and get a big out for us. So start training their bodies to have some of that time in between. And how well can you maintain a soft focus for that hour and a half before you get called in? And when I do call in our guys in the bullpen, I call it randomly. So that way those guys don't know when they're coming in next, and it just kind of keeps them on alert, you know, especially if they're shagging balls or doing some drill work on the side, and all of a sudden I call them in, they come in and they get their work done. So trying to simulate some of those things I think are really important. The bullpen routine I want to talk about today is called our time bullpen. And one of the things I love about our time bullpen, and I think this is – This is really, really good. It's an opportunity for us to gauge competitiveness and just see how well they can compete in this environment. So basically what I'll do is I'll do like a five inning, kind of an inter squad day simulation game, but it's five innings. It's 1 minute per inning. It's two pitchers per mound. And the five innings will be, we're going to do one inning of fastballs to the glove side. You're going to go one inning of fastball arm side. You're going to go one inning of changeups. You're going to go one inning of breaking balls. And you're going to go one inning of a combination drill. We're going to throw fastball, curveball, changeup. And so what you'll do is in that 1 minute, you're going to go out and compete in the strike zone. You're going to get as many pitches in as you can in that 1 minute. And one of the things that we talk about is obviously making sure that we're down in the zone and making sure that we're focusing on our strike percentage. So at that point, what we'll do is we'll work two pitches a piece. You know, so we'll go every two pitches, you're going to start out of the windup, then you're going to go out of the stretch with the runner on first. Then you're going to go two pitches out of the windup, and then when you go back to the stretch again, you're going to go with the runner on second. So again, you're working as many pitches as you can in that 1 minute, but you want to try to work with as much strike effectiveness as you can. And so for every two pitches, you'll go windup, stretch, and then go from there. And then what they'll do is they'll get themselves loose, and then they'll throw for 1 minute. I'll put those guys on the clock, okay? And as soon as they get done with that last pitch of 60 seconds, they run out to the center field wall, and then they run back, and they got 60 seconds to get that done. In the meantime, the other pitcher is going to be throwing his bullpen at the same time while he's running. And so what that does, that kind of puts a little pressure that, hey, he's got 60 seconds to get his work done. When that 60-second clock is done, then he goes off to his run. The first guy is now coming back from his run. If he runs really hard, he's got a chance to maybe catch his breath. If he's kind of not running very hard, then he might have to jump right back on the mound, depending on how much time that takes. And then he jumps into the second inning, which now is a fastball arm side. He goes 60 seconds, boom, he goes. Then the next guy jumps in. And so what that does is just it creates a lot of work. It creates a little bit of some chaos there, and it creates some competitiveness. And so I think it's a great bullpen. And when I first have these guys, I let these guys, I let them go through the rules and we go to work on it. And there's so many things that we get to work off of that thing, which is really, really good. So they go 1 minute. Typically, a solid pace is going to be about six pitches, 5 to 6 pitches. And it's crazy how in the first inning, these guys will try to get 8, 9 pitches in. By the time they get to the fifth inning, they're going about 4 or 5 pitches. And the whole thing at the end, I say, hey, you started off at 9 and you went to 5. I mean, what's going on there? It's like, well, I started to get tired. Well, that's the thing is, hey, we got to be able to maintain this whole thing. And so they kind of forget that they don't need to rush. There is no clock in the game per se. I mean, there is, but, you know, where we have to get back on the rubber. But there is no clock in saying that, hey, you got to throw one pitch per every 2 seconds. It's nothing like that. So to me, it's just make sure that you're going through your routine, stay in command of your routine. Don't let the game get fast on you. You know, do a good job of just focusing one pitch at a time and don't feel like you have to rush. But, you know, you start to see how guys start to fatigue. Their breathing starts to go out of gets out of whack. They start to forget that they, you know, are supposed to go from windup to stretch. All of a sudden now they've thrown 4 pitches out of the windup. And, you know, it's just really interesting how much the game will speed up on these guys. And I just think there's a lot of opportunities to teach there. And the biggest one is just breathing, making sure that they can, you know, keep their breath, stay under control, focus one pitch at a time. And this is also a great conditioning drill, too. So I think there's just a lot of things that we have an opportunity to work on that is really, really helpful in that regard. So to me, we have 2 mounds, so we'll actually crank out 4 guys at a time. So we'll go 2 guys on the first inning and 2 guys waiting in the wings. And in the first time that they ever do this, it's just a great teaching opportunity. I don't record it just because, you know, I want to see how these guys do. And then the second time I do it, then I start tracking every single pitch. And then we start to be a little more forceful in how we're trying to execute these pitches. And it becomes a lot more of a learning experience for these guys. And then again, when I start charting these bullpens, it goes into the bullpen. They know exactly where they're at. They know when their next bullpen is again. And now they get a chance to try to increase those numbers and get to the percentages that we need so that they can, you know, continue to keep elevating their game. So to me, that is one of my favorite bullpens that we get to do. And I think that's great. So, you know, we talk about pre-practice goals and real easy. And I said this earlier is, you know, we don't have a lot of opportunities to spend time with these guys. So we'll go with pre-practice goals. And the goals are very, very simple. Like, you know, I'll bring them up today and say, hey, I really want to do a good job of throwing the ball with downhill angle. And, you know, at the end of practice, I'll bring them in and we'll talk about, hey, there's a couple guys that did a good job. There's a couple guys that need to get a little bit better and they need to focus on it. And, you know, just trying to find something every single day that we can get better at. But I also want to make sure I mention at the end of practice so that I know that they got to be accountable for it. And then when I say something like that, what it does, it holds that particular person accountable and helps him keep his teammates accountable. So to me, that's a big deal. If we can create these daily goals, and they can be repetitive goals as well, but it's just something that to keep those guys focused on something, and I think it works quite a bit. In regards to coaching, I'll tell you what, the most coaching that I'll do, and we'll work really hard in our pitch development and our bullpens, but I try to work the hardest in our practice in our long toss program. When we start focusing on, you know, the direction of the ball, the flight of the ball, that's where I want to do most of my coaching. Typically, you know, coaches will start talking about practice as guys are starting a long toss. I want to be out there with those guys. I want to make sure that those guys are dialed in. If they're not getting into a good set, they're not getting into a good breath, they're not getting into a good hold, they're not executing pitches, I want them to know about it. Because, again, that's the 15 minutes that they don't get back. And I feel like if we can create great habits there, that's got an opportunity to translate to what's going on in the bullpen. It's got a great opportunity to translate to what's going on live in the game. And so, to me, I want them to be greedy with their time. I want them to be as good as they can for those 15 minutes of their long toss, that they become a master of manipulating the baseball every single day and being aware of their body, how it moves, how the release point works. And then, obviously, paying attention to all the different days. You know, there's days that are going to feel great. There's going to be days that they don't feel very good. You know, how do you overcome those days? And I think every opportunity – or each day is an opportunity to really start putting that feather in your hat of, yeah, I had to deal with this today. I had 4-hour watch from 12 to 4 in the morning. I didn't feel great, but I still got to go out and compete. This is what I got to do, you know. So we're just trying to create as many opportunities there as we can. So I think that's really, really helpful for us in moving forward. So, and I think that's about it. Andrew, I only had 20 minutes on the clock, right? I think I went over my time a little bit.
No, you're good. I actually I allotted a little bit more time for our first two guys just because hitting and pitching usually takes a little bit longer and usually gets a few more – we get a few more questions. So we'll go ahead and open up the Q&A, which is good. Okay. That's really good info, Coach Applegate. We do have some questions in the Q&A, please. Continue to put some more cues in there. And we will get them answered for you. So, Coach Parker, you're back with us, right?
Yes, sir.
Very good. All right. First question here to Coach Parker from Gabe Alvarez. What other tools do you use to show and teach the use of the lower half?
Just video, basically, and just show them how it works and show them how elite-level guys are doing it. Are our guys elite Major League Baseball players right now? No. But the more that we can compare the two of them, coach's eye is a huge benefit for us, and it's extremely affordable. I think it's like $3. And right. You can kind of dive in. You can compare the two screens. You can put your guy on one side with the major league hitter that you're trying to replicate on it. on the other side. So that's something that we do a lot with. But guys that struggle with the lower half, we will just do kind of different drills in order to show them and get them to feel it. If you can feel it, you can fix it, right? Like, I think it goes from pitching as well. Rich, it's called Coach's Eye. Coach's Eye is the app. But anything in athletics, if you can feel it, you can fix it. The guys that can't feel it, you got a long way to go in order to get them to make that adjustment.
Yeah, I like that. If you feel it, you can fix it. That's solid. Really, really good. All right, let's go to pitching. We'll just go back and forth here, all right? Let's go to pitching. Bobby, understanding from Rodney Velarde, understanding that big velocity is an eye catcher, and it's what gets kids noticed. Where do you view the aspects of command and movement with regard to pitching? Age-old question here, would you prefer 90-plus with no command or 85 with command and then try to teach velocity? So let's stay away from the hot-button ethos of this question, and let's just say, do you feel like it is easier or more attainable for you to teach command or velocity?
Well, that's, you know, it's a good question. The number for me actually is an 85. If I can find a guy that's 86, I think he's going to be hungry enough to start chasing that 90. So the 86 is more of my magic number. It's not the 85, but I would prefer the guy 86 with command because I feel like, you know, in the college baseball game, there's more sometimes I feel there's more late bloomers than early risers, and you can take that big arm. But I think in regards to what Coach was just mentioning, if you don't have feel, it's going to take a long time for it to become really noticeable to make those changes. One of the things that we struggle with at the academy is we don't have as much time as some of the other schools, especially with like summer baseball. Our guys aren't going to get in another 50, 60 innings in the summer. So we don't have the opportunity to really develop and be with those guys with the, you know, to develop that command. So I would rather take a guy with command and then continue to work, you know, changing his body by getting in the weight room. And somebody's got a little bit more savvy with ability to pitch because it's really going to hard to develop that pitch ability when you're not getting the innings in that you need. So to me and our needs at the academy, I would take the 86 with command, obviously thinking that there's more in the tank.
Right. All right, we're going to go to Coach Parker. Same question. We're going to go Coach Parker and then Coach Applegate from Rich Moretta. So Coach Parker first. Mindset-wise, is there a distinct difference between a college player and a service academy player? If so, what is that difference, and how do you feel you can use what you learned at the service academy to enhance the mindset of non-service academy players? Like, how does it translate?
I think there is. Again, I'm kind of new to the academy. I took the job last August, but I think our guys are just somewhat mentally tougher. Like coaches kind of reference with their summer training, they go through things that your average student doesn't go through. So when adversity hits our guys or things creep up, they tend to have a better feel to just let it go and to move on to the next thing. They don't sit and dwell. They don't pout. You know, I think we've all been around those guys, even youth levels or wherever, that tend to play a pity party and have the poor me, to where our guys don't have that. They have the ability to shake it and the attitude of I'm going to find a way to fix it, because in their future careers in the military, they don't have a chance to sit and pout, right? They've got to find a way to come up with an answer to help the people right next to them. So yeah, I think there is a major difference in using that to help somebody else, just instill the mindset that it's not okay. A lot of guys set themselves up for failure. Even during competitions, like Coach was talking about with his bullpen routines, where they'll, you know, as they step up, we play a game knockout just off of a tee. And they'll step up, and if they have a chance to get knocked out, they'll say, oh, well, I'm not going to do this. So that the result, if they don't get the result they're looking for, they actually don't get so disappointed. And our guys have a tendency to not have that mindset. They're trying to compete all the time and beat the guy next to them. So we don't have the pity parties, at least with our guys.
Coach Applegate, what do you think?
Yeah, I would agree. First of all, you know, a lot of the guys that come to the academy answered the challenge to say, hey, listen, I want to be I want to be better than average. I want to go out there and I want to be a part of big things. And so by getting to the academy, these guys are challenging themselves on a daily basis. You know, and one of the things that I noticed, we had a pitcher by the name of Noah Song, who was actually a Team USA guy, did a really good job. He had an opportunity to go out to the Cape, and we got a chance to talk quite a bit. And, you know, one of the things, he goes out to the Cape, and we were talking, guys were like, oh, man, you're from the academy. And, you know, and everybody thought he was going to walk around at attention, and, you know, everyone had to salute him or something like that. It wasn't the case, but he did set himself apart. What he did is when he got to the yard, there was a job to be done and he had to go do it. You know, it was interesting. He said that, you know, he got in there and he would start to get his cord work in and get his toss work in. There wasn't a lot of talking. There's just, you know, it's just, you know, he's learned how to be self-sufficient and self-motivating guy. And if there's something to be done, he's going to get that part done. And I think that really helped him and his teammates. When he was playing there, because they looked around and said, wow, you know, this guy's kind of got it together. He's kind of all business. But to be honest, Noah was learning from them just as much as they were learning from Noah. And I thought it was great. But I thought what it did more than anything, it just allowed everyone's focus to really go up. Those are the things that you learn at the academy. You know, you don't have a lot of time in the day. You got to really be efficient with what you're doing. And I think it teaches those guys a lot of self-confidence and they have the ability to get tasks done. So. You know, I think those are some of the things that the academy really does. And I think that rubs off on the guys that, you know, at other schools, you know, is just learning how to stay diligent with your time.
Very good. Coach Parker, Ben wants to know what are the top three hitting drills off the tee for 12U, 13U that we can pass along to the teams practicing at home?
That would be the bread and butters, the absolutes of basically our hitting program. Hands only being the first one. It gets your hands on path. It gets you going. It keeps everything back through the middle of the field. Number two would be no stride. Again, just eliminating the lower half. And the leg kick or the foot strike, it's already at foot strike. So, and then going into slow load. Because, again, late and hard don't play. We're trying to be easy and early with everything we do. And it's the thing that separates, I think, elite-level college hitters from average hitters, or it separates elite-level 13-year-old hitters. Their ability to slow the game down. They make, like, professional guys make 98 look like it's 91. So you wonder how those guys are taking pitches right off the side of the plate. They see it. They're not sped up. So I think slow load's a huge thing for us. But those three things – again, we can connect offline or whatever, and I can find a video and send it to whoever's interested. But those are the three pillars that we're trying to work off of.
Perfect. Coach Applegate, that was a two-part question. Now we're saying, what are the top three pitching drills to have 12 or 13 U kids use at home to improve command and or work on new pitches?
Oh, good question. You know, to me, it's to me, we have an opportunity to jump into bullpens. And what I'd like to have those guys do is try to stand-ins, try to have something, a target in there to where, you know, they just don't get so comfortable just throwing to a catcher. I'd rather have a dummy in there or a hitter in there and trying to create as much live as they can and just get rid of the fear of, you know, facing a hitter, but let alone, you know, overcoming that that overconfidence of not throwing somebody in there. Developing pitches is really difficult because I feel like, you know, guys are trying to speed up that process, trying to throw spin a little bit more than they're focusing on fastball command. You know, I like to see those guys try to work more of a changeup. You know, it's really, really difficult. We're trying to create swing and misses at that 12-year-old level. Well, you know, we're not trying to create swing and misses. If you get a swing and miss, you know, 0-0 count, it doesn't mean anything. It's just a strike. You know, we really have this theory of, hey, we want to be on or out with less than three pitches. Now, not everybody plays a lot of catch on defense at that time, but, you know, you still got to work on your pitch efficiency. We talk about that with our older guys. You know, it's great you got us to the fifth inning, but you got 112 pitches now, so you're out of the game. So now you don't get a chance to affect the game. But if you threw a ton of strikes and you're in the fifth inning of 72 pitches, man, you got a chance to finish this thing up for us. So, you know, I think that – you know, they can't be afraid of being hit. And I think that they got to go out and continue to throw live and try to work in changing speeds as opposed to trying to create swing and miss. And if they were going to try to create some spin, I'd try to put some rules on it, meaning like I wouldn't throw spin until after you get two strikes, things like that, to where, you know, you're trying to minimize a little bit of your pitch count and the overuse of some of those pitches.
All right, time for a couple more questions here. Let's get back to hitting real quick. Good one here, Logan. How much time do you put into the daily hitting routine that focuses on external results and not so much internal mechanics, like execution, getting the job done? How much, you know, time do you put into that every day?
The majority of it. So you do have your bread and butters, you have your drill series, but it sets you up to have success, to be able to execute. So we, if you noticed on the drill series tab, there was not one that just said game swing. If you have a bad game swing, then why are you going to sit there and practice a bad game swing over and over and over again? You're an idiot. So let's not do that. So let's build it with our drill series and then let's go execute it, whether it be in a front toss setting, again, hitting with a purpose, or whether it be on the field with angled machines or a machine at you or a live inner squad, or I call it dead arm BP, a coach throwing BP to you. Having situations in there to where it's not just poolside home run. Like a poolside home run does nothing to fire me up as a hitting coach. Our guys are big enough and strong enough to do that. So how about a backside double to the good gap? Like, let's go a backside bullet, for instance. That fires me up. That means your barrel's in the zone. So I think it's all built into the practice plan. I know Coach Cook's going to talk more on that later, but how do you set it up? How do you set up your BP? Is it detail-oriented? Is it focused? Or is it, hey, you're going to take five rounds of five with no purpose? So, again, just instilling that from the get-go.
Very good. Friend of the program, friend of USA Baseball, Tanner Vesely with the question here for Bobby Applegate. Can you go more into the catch play and release point? Ball flight lower than release point? What's the distance? Can you just expound on that a little bit?
Sure. I didn't know if I was going to have time to go through the whole throwing program, but just real quickly, two things that I control and two things that our players control. Each day I'm going to control the distance and I'm going to control the time. Two things that they get to control. They control the frequency, they control the effort. And so, you know, to me, those guys have an opportunity to work within that load. And so what I'm really trying to do is just manage their workload and their volume. And then I let them show me what they're capable of doing. And that starts to expand as they start to do some things. Typically, we're working about a minute apiece. We're going 30-foot intervals. And as we start to go back, we start to put a little more air into it. When we start to go forward, we'll start throwing the ball on a line. And so basically, once we get past 90 feet, I like to see a little more arc on the ball. But realistically, if I'm releasing the ball up here and if I'm going chin high, I want that ball to just land lower than where I released it. And if I can do that, I'm showing some feel that I can throw the ball with a little bit of down angle. And it doesn't have to be significant down angle. I just want the ball to be lower than you released it. And if the ball is starting to sail up, then let's see if we can make a simple adjustment with our fingers on release and then help us from there. Anything that has an arc, I don't mind, as long as it just lands right on your partner's chest. And if we can do that, now you're showing me feel with some distance as well. So we'll work out from 180 to, you know, and I'll give those guys time beyond that. But we'll work at 30-foot intervals until we get to a long toss, and then they're on their own. And then I give them what they want on those long toss days, and then we bring them back in.
Very good. This was a question from Jim Comsberger to Coach Applegate. But, again, I want to flip it to both of you because there's so many – there's so much tie-in here. So, Coach Parker, do you have a separate and standalone physical training program starting in August for just baseball? So, after summer training – is baseball physical training an add-on to academy physical training? Are there concerns of overtraining? Is there do they have a separate dietitian for baseball requirements? How does that work, the academy? Coach Parker, start it, and then Bobby, just go right after him.
No, after the summer training's done, they're ours. So they do take some different classes, like a military movement basically like a gymnastics type course. They mm-hmm. take survival swim, which guys that can really swim enjoy that class. So they have those requirements, but I mean, that's again, a 50 minute segment for 8 weeks. So, no, when they come to baseball in August, we get them. So they go through, we implemented TPI, Titleist Performance Institute with our entire program last year, showed huge benefits to just how our guys move and can assess them and get exercises to work on their deficiencies. So, we start implementing those with our strength and conditioning staff. And then our nutrition piece is new last year, but it's $3.5 million dedicated outside of the mess hall. So every team room at the academy at our place has three fridges fully stocked. And you're looking at chicken parms to yogurts to parfaits to chicken salads, you name it, you got it. That's a huge asset to our guys to be able to maintain weight while staying active, and doing things like that. So no, come August, we got them and they go back to military training. And that's a huge emphasis for the first 4 weeks for us. We break it down our fall, is basically getting those guys out of summer training, especially the freshmen, the plebes coming out of Beast, to try to make them more functional again. Cause there's not a whole lot of functional baseball moves happening during that event.
Coach Applegate?
Yeah. So very similar to ours. I mean, we're so competitive with one another, Coach Parker, that whatever you guys were doing, we're doing, and whatever we're doing, you guys are doing. So
right.
I want you to drop a $3.6 million
there we go.
And Bobby, that's what I want to hear out of Navy.
That's so right.
Like, oh, 3.5, that's nice. We got 3.6.
That's right, 3.6. And we got four.
Yeah, there you go.
Patience. No. You know, we'll get our guys in August and it becomes baseball. And at that time, you know, they're going through such a new time for them in plebe summer. They're doing more push-ups, they're doing more pull-ups, or they're doing a lot of things, and we just want to get them back to flexibility again. So in August, we actually will go through an in-season CRESI program to where it's just kind of focused on getting them back into shape. And so for the pitching, we have our weightlifting program right at the baseball field. Everything that ties into their lifting is tied into their throwing. So that's really, really helpful. And so they're not having to go through different areas to do that. And, you know, by doing that, that just allows us to get back into better throwing shape. And then once we get into that fall, then we'll start to ramp it up a little bit more into the off season, which is awesome. But in regards to August, you know, just baseball only. But when those guys get introduced, their body starts to change. I mean, those guys start doing more push-ups. They start to, you know, I think there's been a fear of the weight room. Those guys really start to engage in it, and they really start to enjoy being there and do a good job with it. So a lot of guys start jumping in on their own just a little bit more just because they want to get better at it. In regards to the dietitians as well, they got that stuff, but we also have, you know, when they're feeding the brigade, we have dietitians that are making sure that they get the right meals and get enough calories there for as much as they're walking around, running around, and doing what they need to do from a day-to-day basis.
Awesome. Well, I think we're going to end it right there for session one. So I know B-Mad, that I'll introduce in a minute, has got a lot that he needs to cover. He's going to get a few extra minutes here starting session two. Coach Applegate, Coach Parker, can't thank you enough for making time for us today. On behalf of USA Baseball and myself, thank you for what you do. Please thank your players for what they do. We sincerely appreciate them, and we appreciate you all pouring into them and creating great men to keep our country safe. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Andrew.
Absolutely. Thanks for having us.
We'll see you.
Awesome. Thank you all.
Take care.
All right, let's get fired up for session two. I'm going to introduce Bryan Madsen, who's an assistant coach at Arroyo Grande High School in California. Also, former United States Marine Corps member. And if you have not listened to the podcast recently on Stick and Ball TV with Coach Jeremy Schiedinger, she's interviewed B-Mad, and it's a really, really good listen. I heard it yesterday when I was mowing the yard. And, man, what an interesting story he's got. We don't have enough time for his story right now, but check out the Stick and Ball podcast with Coach Keats and Bryan Madsen, a guy who is heavily involved with USA Baseball, who's an OG Necton, and who has made a lot of great, great contributions to our country and to a lot of young men along the way. Bryan Madsen, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, thank you. Thanks for having me.
You get some extra time today, my man, for your hotline. You might get through two pages of it instead of one.
Most base running, it's like, hey, you don't have as much time. So
that's right.
I'm kind of jealous because when I was in the Marine Corps, I didn't have those kind of facilities like the Navy does now for that stuff. That's nice. Yeah, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. Base running. So I'll just dive into it. And I'm going to go pretty fast, but all my information is going to be on here. If you guys need anything, email, all that contact stuff, don't be afraid. I have a lot more videos and things that I'm not doing on here. Our idea running bases is to make the defense look bad. That's what we want to do. We want to make you look lazy. We want to make you look like you don't know how to play the game. We want to take advantage of everything that you do. There's some things that we do different. We do break the rules. Everybody always says we don't steal third with two outs. I will steal third with two outs. If you give it to us, we'll take it. But there's some standards that we have with our guys. And I'll just kind of go through them real quick. And like I said, I'm going to move quick, but get a hold of me later and we'll go through it. All right. For us, no matter what we do, everything on the baseball field starts with three hard steps, whether you're coming out of the dugout, whether you're going to stretch, whether you're going to throw, if you're running out of the box, everything's three hard steps. It's three hard steps. Then you need to pick up the ball. It's three hard steps going back out on the field. I find that if you take three hard steps, it's really hard to stop your momentum. So, you know, and go into a walk. So we do everything in three hard steps. We never run singles. We always run 180 feet at a time until we're stopped, whether that be going home to first on a base hit, whether it be second to home, first to third. We never assume that we're stopping until we're stopped. So we do a few things to kind of encourage that. We are very aggressive. We're not careless. There's a big difference. We do run the straightest lines possible. So I'm not a question mark guy. I kind of found that that doesn't work. We try and set our angles as soon as we can out of the box. Just like defense, extra bases are extra runs, right? So if we can get an extra 90 feet, that's why it's big to me. If I can get to third base with two outs, well, that may take some pitches away from certain pitchers because they don't want to go wild pitch or something. We'll set you up early in the game. We may not do everything we want to do for seven innings, nine innings. We're going to see what you do, and we're going to set up and figure out what we can get out of you later. If your pitcher's a robot, we will feed on you. We feed on robots. So we look for tendencies. We have charts. We have all that stuff that essentially lets us know what you're doing. If you do the same thing over and over, we'll take advantage of it. Dirt ball reads all the pressures on the catcher. We look at it like, if you can block it, pick it up, and throw us out, then good for you. Do it again the next time. So we're going to try and do that. Coming out of the box, we're trying to get right foot out of the box first. We have to know where the ball is. We don't run with our head down. We don't. You know, you ever the little league thing of put your head down, run to first base? That doesn't work. So we have to know where the ball is. I've seen a ton of guys hit ground balls that were misplayed and they run through the bag. And that's just bad base coaching, bad base running. Understand what's happening on the field. Understand if you can get an extra base because someone's looking another way. Understand if there's an error. Understand if the left fielder bobbled the ball. Know all that stuff. Running through the bag, we do something a little different. We a lot of people look to the right and then see where the ball is. We actually break down immediately when we hit the bag. We do a chop step and we turn our shoulders parallel with the baseline. And we are looking essentially at the fence or into foul territory, into the stands. And then we drop step with our right foot. And we go to second base if there's a way we can get to second base. If it's a good throw and we beat it out, we still open up our shoulders and we continue to open them and we look at second base. And if the shortstop puts his head down or they leave second base vacant, we'll take second base then too. We're always trying to look for something new. And I have videos on that if you guys email me. So that's one way we do it. We're big on the chop step with the inside move. It is a little faster. It's not a ton faster, but they take a lot of pride in it. And it's something cool that they do that's their own. And I have found if they make it their own, they're going to put more into it. Let's see. Making turns. When we make turns, we have to go. We practice turns so hard and so sharp that I have guys fall down routinely until they get their turn sharper, We actually have a grass lane until the cutout at first base. So we get a lot of falling there. We get a lot of falling on the base. And we'll paint the corner of the base, and you try to hit it with your right foot. You try and get a good shoulder lean. Snap your head looking at the pitcher. And sometimes you go down until you figure out, until your body adjusts itself and acclimates itself into what it's supposed to do there. We don't slow down on our turns. I know a lot of people will start breaking down. We are going to go hard until the outfielder gets the ball cleanly, and then we will break down with our shoulders facing whatever fielder that is, whether it be the right fielder, center fielder, left fielder, and we will go back hard after that. After you've shown that you've picked the ball up, and if you pick it up and you lob it, we may try and go too. Let's see. Expect the back pick. We are a big back picking team defensively, so we kind of train like we're playing us. So we never just jog back. If we get back picked, you're probably not playing for a game or two after that. As far as running lanes, we use cones, trash cans, pitching dummies, anything, ball buckets to make. I believe you have to have barriers. You have to have, when you chop step at first base, I want you stopping at about 8 feet. I don't want you, there's nothing I hate than a guy breaking a ball, beating out a ball, and continuing to run into the outfield. It's terrible. Chop step, you need to stop. I try and get them between 8 and 10 feet, and by the time that, their shoulders should be turned, looking at foul territory, ready to drop the right foot and inside move to second base. Let's see. So, yeah, cones. I don't have an angle. I don't have a certain thing. I'll start wide. I'll start with three cones down the line, and we'll just push until essentially from the military, like using a weapon, we're going to go as fast as we can till we make a mistake, and then we're going to back down. We're going to work on our fundamentals, and then we're going to try and push past that limit again. So I'll have them go angles that I know they can't make, just so they can feel that, and then you move them back a little bit, and they're really good, and then they just keep getting better. So don't be afraid to fail to find those proper routes. If you could run a perfect straight line without slowing down to every base, that'd be perfect. It's just not possible. Like I said, know what's happening with the ball. That's a huge deal. So here's one thing that I'm really big on. And we talk about the mental game everywhere else. We talk about it hitting. We talk about it one pitch at a time on defense. When the ball gets put in play, you have to go through all these progressions. And you have at first base, when you're base running, you have to go through all these progressions, and they apply at every base. What's the situation? As soon as you get on base, what's the situation? This is all pre-delivery, and you have to just flow to this. What's the outs? What's the score? What's the inning? What signs do we get? What are we looking for? Do I know the signs? Okay, so we have to process that. Are there other runners? Is there a runner on second base? Am I at first base? If I'm at first base, I want more of an open lead so I can see if the runner at second goes. How am I going to take my lead? Am I going to do a jump lead? Am I going to do a standing still lead? Defensive positioning, where are they at? Where's the outfielders? Where's the infielders? Once again, what's the situation? These are all things that you have to progress through quickly without sitting there and going, how many outs? Where's the outfielder? At first, and that's how we teach it. We literally have this. I have this checklist, and I just go through it. What's this? That's that. As you go faster and faster, you start making those situations easier and easier. What am I doing? Am I stealing? Am I delaying? Is there a squeeze? Tells. So if I'm stealing, are there any tells? Did we talk about what the pitcher's doing? Do we talk about if you give something away? Will an average jump work, or do I have to get a shuffle lead? Is it a hit and run? What do I do on a hit and run? What do I do if the ball goes in the air? Lefty. Off left-handers, we jab step a lot. So that's something we have to work on. Am I faking the steal? So things like that. In the jump lead, got to be horizontal. Your right foot has to go first. Your feet need to stay connected. And a lot of different pitchers have different reads on where they start and where you can start. So we were lucky enough to sit with Jarrett Broughton, and it could be the bill of the hat. It could be a ton of things, but that's paying attention in the dugout. That's paying attention in the first couple innings. If you can get on base, what are we doing? What type of pitcher is there? There are a lot of curveballs in the dirt. We're huge dirt ball reads. There's few things more frustrating than if we miss a dirt ball. Curveballs are a lot easier to read. Fastball's a little tougher. If you don't go on a fastball, they're a lot easier to pick. I'm fine with that. But if I get a humped up curveball that hits the plate and you don't go, then we're going to have a problem. How's the catcher throw and move? Did they take infield, outfield? How did he look then? Is he better one way than the other? What's the time to the plates, to the picks? Did the first base coach tell me anything? Who's up? Where's the catcher setting up? Butch Chaffin told me this. You don't see a lot of catchers move closer to the plate on a fastball. You don't see a lot of catchers move inner half of the plate on an off-speed pitch. So things you have to look at, you have to pay attention. And all this needs to be done a lot faster than I just explained it. So we have to continually work with pressure in practice to get there. And now this, when all that fails, what's my contingency, right? Back to the military. When all that fails, now what am I going to do? So and that's all before the delivery. That's all before we know what's going on. During the delivery, am I stealing? Did I get a good jump or a bad jump? If you get a bad jump and you get thrown out at second, that's a bad thing in our book. You get a good jump, you get thrown out, then they did their job. No big deal. You're not going to hear a word. Did they pick? If I got picked, what part of the baseline should I be in? If I'm picked in the first baseman, I should obviously get closer to the grass on the inside part of the line. Things like that. There's a ton of stuff going through our heads. Pick up the target on the base that you want to go to. I think there was a study that said like 65% of guys that were thrown out did not run straight to second base. You may think, if there's a string between the backside of first base and the backside of second base, and you're a foot off that, well, that's an extra foot that you could have. It's not a straight line. So you need to stay on that string as you would and keep a straight path. I think sometimes if you look at a target just behind the base, it keeps you straighter. Let's see. Where am I at here? Aggressive secondary if we're not stealing. We go out hard and we get back hard. The best way to not have teams backpick you is to show them that you hustle back every time, that you cannot be backpicked. If you're running back and forth every time hard, they're not going to try. And if they do try, they're going to rush and could end up in right field. So we really need to not be lazy. And if you don't do that, you don't play for us. That's kind of what we're getting to here. Dirt ball reads, catchers tells, shin guard. Some guys go for shin guard angle. I have not gotten good at that yet. So we are still out of the hand trying to read an angle. If you're looking at the catcher's shin guards, you're looking at the hitting zone, which may give you a little jump. I'd like to get better at that. Let's see. So like I said, the aggression on the dirt ball, we're probably overly aggressive and we'll get thrown out more in the fall than we need to, but it's trying to push that limit. Just like making turns, base running is you have to be pretty arrogant. I believe you got to be a little arrogant, super confident, and you can't believe you're going to get thrown out if you want to be a good base runner. All the best baseball stealers had a pretty good amount of confidence. Okay. All the best base stealers in baseball. So I'm fine with a guy thinking he's not going to get thrown out until you keep getting thrown out. Then we need to change something. So, after contact, we have to know where the ball goes. Did the ball go up? Did the ball go down? Is it a line drive? I go to youth games and I hear freeze on a line drive, and it kills me. We go back. We step back on line drives. It's really hard. I'd rather you go in that way and lose a step going to second and not go first to third than get a double play. Here's a big one. Catcher's whiffing. It happens in high school all the time. You swing and miss. Catcher just misses the ball, and you don't follow the ball, and it's going to the backstop, and we didn't get a good jump. It's really frustrating. So really pay attention to not just the hitting zone, but where the ball's going. A lot of base runners, once they see the angle come out of the hand, they realize it's not going to be a dirt ball. They kind of just look at the hitter. Don't do that. Follow the ball. See where it goes. Second base, it's all the same progressions. All the same progressions. What are we going to do when the ball's hit? And all those need to be made really fast. So the way we do that is we don't take any – we don't run bases ever just to run bases. I don't think it's a great conditioning thing. We run some cycles where you're home to first to third, third to home, but they all have a purpose, and they all are within certain limits and time limits. So I guess it's a type of conditioning, but I don't think learning to run bases as conditioning is a great thing. We try and do it early in practice. Everybody says base running is important, but you really don't put that much into it till the end of practice most of the time. Like, hey, let's go run bases and get our conditioning in. We do it really early. We learn something new. We literally start, here's how you run to first base. Here's how you break down, little league style. And then we don't get up until our more advanced stuff till later in the fall or even into the season. So I think that, like, I think everybody likes to say base running is important, but you don't really want to spend the time on it because it takes away from things that coaches think are more important. And they're not. I mean, so like I said, an extra base could mean an extra run. So I think if you could set out 15 minutes after throwing or something, maybe when the pitchers are playing catch or whatever, you could get better at base running and just go down the line. I have a list. Bart, can I share my screen? Let's see. I'm going to try and do this here. So the way we do it, and I got this also from Jim Machieski. He's super organized. If you ever want to feel like you don't know what you're doing with the list, look at Jim. Bart, can we see that?
Yeah, you're good. Be mad.
Okay, thanks. These checklists. So what we have, it's just what we're doing, home to first, balance, when we cover it, right? And I just check off or write the date when we're going to cover it. And there's tons of things, and I can give people these if you want. You see chaos. Chaos is a certain play we run, and we let the players come up with it on their own. And this year, I know some guys wanted to call it Nana because it's an oldie but a goodie. So we went with Nana this year. And if they're into it, then I'm into it. So that's fine.
Hey, Bryan, could you full screen that or scroll over left, right? We're only seeing half of it, I think, right now.
All right. I told you I'm not very smart. All right. Let's see. How about that? Is that better?
There you go, man. That's it. That's the one.
Okay. So I have everything right here, home to first, when we cover it. And it's everything essentially that you need to know as a base runner. How do we react on a ground ball air? How do we return to the bag? If we return standing, we go to the right, the home plate side of first base with a proud chest, making it harder for the first baseman to get across us. If we're diving back, we're going back to the third, to the right field side. We go through all this like they've never done this before. There are, in all reality, at lower levels, there's no base running being taught. You have to teach these kids like they know nothing, because a lot of times they don't. They don't understand what they're doing. This left-handed first move, are we going on first move? Are we looking at his head? All these things we will go through. As you can see, we're pretty extensive. And we'll mark down when we cover it. And then when we come back, so say these four things are going to be covered today. Well, tomorrow we'll go through these next four, but we're going to hit on these four again too. So it just keeps building and building and building off of the fundamentals until we're down here doing the shuffle steal. We're down here working on spin moves, which way we should slide into third head first. I do teach a little bit of a inside move at third base also. Some of the balls down the line, if there's multiple runners and you'll see a lot of third base coaches they'll stop the runner coming to third, and then there's a runner on first, and they'll start looking that way. And once they stop the runner on third, that runner on third rounds third, and he's just looking at home, he comes back to the bag. I will have them shuffle step and turn their shoulders towards the left field line, and they become their own base coach. If that left fielder bobbles the ball, then they go on their own. And I'm big on shoulders, you've probably heard, because you see it better. You see everything better than if you just turn your head. The shoulders want to follow. So if I see something and I keep my momentum going and shuffling, well, I can keep going. And I can see it before the third base coach sometimes because he's looking another way. And that's the inside move, reading the left field line with the shuffle. That's all second base. Third base, squeezes. We have a couple different squeezes. Stealing home. I got that from JB at Clemson too. All dirt ball reads are huge for us. First and third. So, I mean, as you can see, we're pretty detailed into all this stuff. We're bringing in a few more first and third plays like this year. Like I said, we're going to get Nana in there a little bit. Fake squeeze, steal second. That never fails. Always, always. I've never seen a first and third fake squeeze, steal second, and the guy going to second gets thrown out. Never seen it. So, and that's, I've got that. I can share that with you guys if you want also. So it's kind of interesting. We try and make it interesting for the kids and then they buy in. So if they'll buy in, then you're going to be a lot better at it. So how much time do I have here, Bart? Couple minutes.
Yeah, you got 2-3 more minutes if you want them.
All right. Okay. So here's a big one for me. The on-deck batter is a base runner. The on-deck base batter is a base runner, and we practice it. We practice them being on deck, being in their mental, getting mentally prepared, getting ready to hit, and then there's a base hit, and they all of a sudden become the third base coach, okay? Not the third base coach, but the third base coach on the field. They have to know where to get behind the plate. They become the director for the guy coming from third base, and we practice it. We will do drills to where get a base hit, and we have the guy from on deck sprints over there, and he makes calls. We practice it in practice. We do it probably didn't do as much last year, a little short a year, but, I mean, we'll do it 4 or 5 times a year where you just know as soon as there's a base hit and there's a guy in second, your reaction is get there. Up, slide, don't get hit by the ball. Do not stop the ball. My final things I think are important. I assume that they know nothing when you teach base running. It's really undertaught at lower levels. Club baseball, I haven't seen a ton of travel coaches talking about base running. Everybody wants to be good at it, but nobody really wants to put the effort in. Know what you have before you decide what kind of base running team you're going to be. All right. And you have to adapt to your players and your talent. If you can't be what you don't have, but you can be aggressive and a good base running team without a bunch of burners. You can. You just have to do all the little things right. Players' attention, get it by doing new and interesting things, even if you don't use it. We run some plays that we'll never use. We talk about double squeeze. We talk about this. We haven't done it for a while, but you have to start off on fundamentals and keeping them interested. Communicating info, keep it simple, keep it in real time. I have keywords, touching. If I touch a guy on the right shoulder, I might be giving him the green light. Is the first baseman super over attentive? Every first baseman wants to be the smartest guy in the field. So I can say something like, hey, get a jump on this pitch to the guy at first base. And the first baseman will start, whistling to the pitcher. It's like, okay, he's a rabbit. I'm in his head, so I can work with him. So we'll come up with things that I'll say just, hey, OG Necton, go now. And nobody knows what it means, but whatever. Base coaches are important. I think they need to stay calm. I think they need to stay where they're at and just look to advance. How do I get further? How do I get to the next base on the next pitch? Keep your bearing. That's a big Marine Corps thing. Not getting overexcited, not getting lost in the moment. Keep your bearing, stay calm and see what's going on. New school leads do work, but they take a lot of work. And we, if I have guys that I feel can do it, we'll introduce it to everybody and you can kind of see which guys can pick it up. They have a little better timing. But we'll work on it in the fall, and it takes a lot of time. And then as far as practice, we force people to steal. We force people to take extra base. There's one scrimmage we do. We have set up where if you do not go two bases at a time, then you're out. It doesn't matter if you get thrown out at second base by 20 feet, because there's, you know, I want the outfielders to work. I want the long hops, things like that. We'll do four outs per inning to where if you get an extra out, as long as you steal within, I don't know, the first three pitches or something. And then just understand, the biggest thing I think is let them understand that they're not going to be getting in trouble by doing what you want them to do, especially high school kids. Like I said that on the podcast, first thing they do when they make a mistake is look at the coach and wonder, oh, how's he reacting? Well, if you flip out when he, you know, gets a good jump and gets thrown out, he's not going to want to do that anymore. So I think you have to be patient. You have to let them learn, and you have to teach instead of just have expectations right off the bat. So I know that was fast. I apologize. I could talk about this all day. So
that's good, man, because a lot of people can't talk about base running all day. So you're one of, one of the diehards. That's great. Thanks so much, man, for being with us today.
No problem, man.
And thank you for your service and for everything you do for USA Baseball and what you did for your country. We appreciate you.
Thank you. It was an honor to serve, and I appreciate it all. Thank you.
Absolutely. All right. And Coach Madsen, if you did not download the PDF, the link that I put in the chat earlier to the presenter notes, Coach Madsen's, all of his contact info is there, along with like five pages of notes on base running. So even if you didn't talk about it or touch on it right now, there's a lot of other notes that are in there. All right. A lot of information. I know that he'd be willing to connect with anybody. Is that right, Bryan?
100%.
Awesome. Thank you so much, sir. All right. We're going to shift gears now. We're going to go from base running to infield play. And it's my pleasure to welcome from the United States Air Force Academy, Coach Jimmy Roesinger. And he is going to talk. He is going to talk infield play today. Jimmy, thanks for joining us. Let's unmute. There you go, baby.
Gotcha. You hear me? All right.
Yeah, we got you.
Awesome. Like you said, Coach Madsen, thanks for your service. Obviously, that's awesome. We got a mutual friend in common with Jared Broughton, with my college roommate. So he's a good man right there. But no, I guess obviously this is a great panel of guys, and Coach Bartman, just thank you for having us all on and putting this together. It's awesome to be a part of this, and to everyone else. Hopefully you can learn a thing or two on infield play. I guess just to give you a little background for me is my played at the University of Dayton, as I said, with Jared Broughton, who's at Clemson now, and then C.J. Gilman, who was formerly at Air Force and is now with the Cincinnati Reds, but jumped into to coaching after being coached by Brian Harrison and Baldwin Wallace. Matt Tallarico is with the Yankees, and then Tony Vittorio. And Matt Tallarico was the guy who kind of got me into the coaching side of things. So jumped in. I was at Lincoln Trail Junior College. Got to work with the infielders, hitters, and did base running and lifting with
I got a timeout you right there, man. Did you just drop a Lincoln Trail Junior College?
I did.
Man.
Kevin Bowers, Mitch Hannes.
A lot of respect for both of those guys, but I got to tell you, man, I was a Wabash Valley guy for 3 years. So I was the pitcher.
Okay.
Right down the road in southeastern Illinois, right down the road. So that was like that was the record stop for me right there. You dropped the Lincoln Trail on me. So
yeah.
I don't interrupt anymore. Feel free.
Yeah, you're good. You're good. Well, I learned a lot about baseball there, and it was great because I got to get my feet wet there, and went from 1 year there to Heidelberg University. Matt Palm and Chad Fitzgerald were the head coaches there, and was a grad assistant there for 2 years, and then on full time for a year and a half after that, and then been out here at Air Force for 5 years. 4 years as the volunteer, and 1 year as a full-time, I guess, 19 games as a full-time guy. So I'm very seasoned as a full-time guy. But giving a little background, it is, Bart, as you said, kind of working with some high school and some youth guys. So I'll sprinkle in a little stuff as well there too, because since I've been here at Air Force. I started a Little League Academy in Colorado Springs. So have a little bit of background into the Little League side of things. So I guess just to give you guys a background of my talk, and obviously I know as Coach has put out my outline, and I think I have the record for the longest outline in USA baseball history. So I guess I can tip my hat on that one. Kind of the breakdown that's going to be for me, and I would like to do the building blocks for game-ready infielder, and kind of the background of that for our guys was getting to watch Arenado play up here in Denver, and one of the things he always talked about was it bounced offensively, I guess, where he said, hey, you know, we'll go and hit batting practice 3 hours before the game. After their 50 minutes of batting practice, they'll sit and they'll be cold for an hour. So he talked about his, just kind of his routine to allow him to feel ready. Cause he said his first few years, it was, he'd get out there and the first AB, he wouldn't be ready to go. He'd take him second, third, fourth AB. And I know we have all had those guys where it's like, we stick a shortstop out there and it's his first time playing short, and you're like, okay, hopefully he fields that first ball, and he usually boots it. So, you know, just trying to make the guys feel comfortable that way. And again, it's not a science or anything like that, just some things that I've put together. And some of our players have said, hey, that really helps out with regards to getting us ready to play, whether it be practice, whether it be game day. So we'll try to jump through all this. The breakdown will be throwing and catch play first, and then we'll go into fielding and vision. I'll kind of be second and third, but I do that together during practice, and then we'll go our focus for the day. Some people will call them everyday drills. Other people will call them primers, and then we'll go into our practice variability, and then lastly, we'll do our data and charting that we have for our guys, and how that reflects in our practice and our game and getting ready. So as we kind of jump into it here, the throwing is the first thing. And I put it there because it's the highest importance for me. It's not necessarily that we're going to go and we're going to throw right away. As Coach Madsen was talking, the base running is huge for us as well too. We typically start out with base running. So for us, it's making sure when we do have our guys go and throw, it's not, hey, we're going to go throw, then we're going to base run, then we're going to go into whether it's individual defense or team defense. So that would kind of be the first thing that I would throw out there, is make sure that we're aligning practice with our throwing routine. So it's not warm up, throw, go base run, and then we got to go into first and third D or cuts and relays, and our guys got to throw again. It just takes time away. And we all know that the time is precious for each one of us, whether that's at the Little League level, high school level, or college level as well too. So just making sure that we can run an efficient practice that way. So for our throwing, I think it's, you know, just a funny story that I think about for our guys is we had two guys this past year. One ended up being our starting left fielder, and the other one is no longer with us. But we started out in the fall, and these dudes, every time they throw in the same spot. It'd be right next to the ball bucket. And they would throw, and the one guy got awful throwing motion, would throw it over his head every single time. And as soon as the coaches would look away, he'd grab another ball out to throw. And so I think where I'm going with that story, is, you know, once you kind of catch on, you give him a hard time about it. But where I'm going with that story is just the importance of being able to play catch. There's nothing worse than doing Little League during the week with the youth academy, where you do defense two times a week and they're playing more fetch than they are playing catch. With our guys, we try to have them long toss depending on what portion of the season it is. We either try to have them long toss three times a week during the fall, or four times when we're out of our fall season, which is the 6 weeks. And for that, I just think about our mentality when we're talking to our guys is, hey, try to throw it over the outfield wall. So they create a little bit of a competition as well as like, I'm the man if I can throw it over the wall. Because I think if you would go around to your respective programs and ask each person and say, at the beginning of the year, do you want to have a stronger arm? Do you want to have a more accurate arm? You know, 10 out of 10 guys are going to say, yeah, of course, coach, I want to do that. And my personal opinion is that you can't do that without long toss. I think also long toss, as I said, with those two outfielders that we had, there's something about knowing when you're 120 feet away, how far, how much effort I need to put into the ball to be able to land it in his area and not running into the guy to the left and not running into the guy to the right. So you're just sending a message to your brain, just saying, hey, this is what I need to do to get it there. And I don't think if you don't challenge yourself to be able to do that, then you'll never learn. I think the other thing that I think about as well too, with our guys, and I'm sure a lot of programs as well out there, is you look around and the number of kids that can't throw batting practice to each other or can't underhand toss to each other, as they expect the coach to be able to do it. I think a lot of that as well too is based upon being able to play catch and long tossing, and know that if you're 5 feet away, you don't have to throw it 100 miles per hour, and create a little feel that way as we go to long tossing. So with our mentality, we'll talk to our guys and we're going to spend 20 minutes long tossing each day. And I say 20 minutes, we stay at 20 minutes. We have a thing called the Seconds app, which is on Apple, and it's, I think it's either $2.99 or $5.99. And it's something that's great for if anybody ever runs camps, because it can hook up to music, but it allows you and gives these guys time. So it's not, hey, we forget about, you know, turn around, we're talking to somebody and we forget what time we started. It keeps track of that time for our guys. You're never going to have a lot of guys that are going to really stretch it out for that 20 minutes unless you time them. And this is something that allows for our guys to keep their arms healthy and really allow them to get loose. The app is called Seconds. And I think it was actually made for workouts for CrossFit, but you can add in time. So we'll do it for our defensive portions as well too, but it's mostly used for our long toss. It's an orange app with a big S on it. And so for that, we'll have them loosen up. On the way out, it's for their arm. On their way in, it's for their feet. And using their legs to come back in on the way out, really elongate, let it loose, elongate the arm, really open up the shoulders, let our guys let it fly. And then as they come in, the infield portion, we'll do some things defensively with the outfielders as well too. But as the infield coach, I'll have them specifically do drills on the way in so they can focus on whatever the daily focus may be that day. I usually try to tailor however we throw on the way in based upon what our team defensive drill is going to be. So that being said, if we're going to do cuts and relays or double cuts, then as they're coming in, they may be able to catch and work on that relay each time that they receive. The long toss, the goals that I want to develop for them is the increase in arm strength, accuracy, and endurance in the arm. For our guys that are throwing, it's going to develop their footwork patterns for throwing. And then for the guys that are receiving, it's going to give them pocket accuracy as well as the footwork that they need for that receiving. As I said, for example, relay, maybe it's double play, whatever it may be. So each time as they're coming in, they might do a double cut relay. They might do a double play feed. The guy that's receiving will have, I got a glove here and just kind of give you a little example. This is a little trainer glove, but we put an X in there. Another way that we might necessarily change it up as well too is put numbers in there, number at 1 through 4, and it's just giving our guys another thing to focus on rather than just, hey, hitting the glove. As I've noticed, and we've taken our, I guess, stats from the years, is that most of our errors occur from throwing. And when I think about the throwing, it's not necessarily like, hey, clean exchange and they go to throw. It's usually a bobble from the exchange. Then they try to muscle up and throw. That's where the error occurs. So then you relate that to, well, is it just because they didn't catch it properly, or they just stink at taking the ball out of their glove? And so as I talk about, when we start extending and going out as far as we can, I'm going to tell them, obviously it's for their arm, but the two things that we're going to focus on is, as I said, the X in the glove, to work on the receiving and seeing where they can get it. But we'll also do something called two grip and throw. And if I just have the glove and the ball here, it's obviously they catch, they try to get it there. Once they pull it out, like, they want to try to get and work the exchange, make sure it's clean. Well, usually what most guys do is once they work that first exchange, it'll just have it in their hand the whole time. So I make sure that our infielders throw it back in their glove. So then when they start to move their feet again, right, they're doing two exchanges every time they go to throw to warm up. So is it annoying? Yeah, probably, to our guys. They probably hate it, but it's something that I for sure pay attention to in the fall and try to be around, because it's not to their fault, but they just do whatever they're going to do if we're not paying attention. So making sure they work that double exchange, because I've seen more throwing errors or more guys safe at first base based upon the bobble out of the glove. And as I said on the way in, again, just some examples of different things that we do. Again, we'll have 14 minutes on the way out, 6 minutes on the way in. And then when we come in, whether it be relay with an arm fake, we'll do the QB drills, whether it's 3 steps, 5 steps drop, throw, whether it's a rollout, whether it's a 5-step drop, and then they're throwing on the run. They'll also work 2-step, 4-step patterns, just like they would do when they're fielding. So that'll be ball and glove again, where they're working the exchange on each one of those. And then the last thing that we've thrown in, I think it was 2 years ago that I started, doing this, is working on just, we play on a turf field. So we've been working on just throwing bounce passes back and forth, because there's nothing like going into IO and we're into a practice and guys are like, hey, short hop, long hop. Well, kind of tough to, if we never work on it, to get good at it. So, an option for our guys to understand, hey, we're going to try to bounce pass it in that situation. As we kind of move down farther into this outline, we'll talk about the feed. We're getting our guys' footwork, started right then and there, so they get in a position to catch a long hop or work on getting, eaten up by a short hop if they're not moving their feet. So the bounce pass is key, and we added that into our pregame IO as a kind of our second to last throw, just to have it in the back of their mind instead of trying to do a amazing Jeter play or stick on their back leg and really try to throw it across and end up throwing it into the stands, because they're trying to show off how great their arm is. Like, hey, if we can just get the exchange out, get off the turf, we're going to be in a good position there. So something to add to that. And like I said, again, we're not going to do all three of those at the same time, but depending on what we're doing that day, we'll tailor our throwing on the way into that. One quick thing that I left off there is band work. At the beginning, we're going to do 5 minutes of band work every single time. Again, going back to the youth side of things, or even low budget programs, high school, whatever it is, depending. When I was at Heidelberg, we would get a full thing of TheraBand and an arm's length, cut it there, just something super easy so you don't have to buy pitcher's bands for every guy on the team. And I think, you know, a whole box of it is about the cost of two pitcher's bands. So something that's super easy to look into. You just have to figure out what the right strength is there. But it's, especially for the youth guys, just making sure you get the younger kids in a rhythm of understanding it's not just show up and go out there. And once, you know, mom takes my bag to the dugout, I grab my glove and grab any ball that I can find and just start chucking it all over the place. It was a freaking nightmare, but have some order and being able to do the bands and know that that's a part of keeping our arm healthy moving forward. So again, very important coming to the throwing aspect, some throwing issues that we've run into with our guys. And I know depending on how most people are, but we have the baseball with the black line on it that will break out at the beginning of the year for our guys. And again, the whole portion of it is just to make sure we get that backspin. Most of our guys that we see trouble with is they're going to get out and around the baseball and create a little cut. So it's not going to create that proper spin that we want end over end. So the baseball with the line gives us a visual for our guys to really create that backspin and throw it. The other thing is we'll get out. We did this with our shortstop and one of our outfielders a lot, but we have them warm up with a football. And so when we have the football here again, when they go to throw, right, they'll be here and they have to pronate properly through the football to be able to create the spiral, especially the teaches for the infielders. When I work with them and throw, guys that struggle sometimes will create a big arm movement this way. And I just say, hey, just keep it here and use your legs to be able to throw to create that proper pronation there. And it gives us a good spin on the ball. And naturally they understand, like, hey, if I use my legs more, I can get the ball there in the proper fashion that I need. It's, and our example is, again, I know a lot of people talk about Tom Brady or whoever it may be, is Tom Brady doesn't take a huge arm swing to be able to throw. He just uses his legs, stays short, and gets rid of it quick there. So those are just some things when we talk about the throwing, and one aspect that we want to make sure that we have a high importance on, because again, that's where most of the errors come from for us. So now as we kind of jump into the next two things, this would be for an example, I guess when we talk about fielding with our feet and vision, this is something where we'll go into our individual defensive period, whether that's during our fall season or during individuals. We're going to start out 5 minutes each day with, we'll do fielding with our feet, is what we call it, and then vision at the same time. So we'll split up the group so we can kill two birds with one stone in that instance. So at the beginning of the year, we kind of go over all the drills that we'll do with our guys. But I think where it first started out is, you know, for us, it's the fielding with the feet. I saw a video, I think it was Jose Iglesias back in the day, and dudes like jumping over balls, ducking under PVC pipes and making throws, and you're just like, man, like that dude is super slick and he has great feet, and all the great infielders have great feet. And you know, of course I see there's one drill where they throw a Swiss ball at him and he's jumping over it and throwing at the same time. So, you know, making myself try to feel athletic, I tried to show it to our guys, and of course my back foot got caught on the Swiss ball and I was face first on the throw. So I usually make the guys show that one from now on. But, you know, it's just things like that where, again, it's trying to create the athleticism. We can't create athleticism if our feet are super heavy. So his video, again, that was probably 5 or 6 years ago, but I always think back to that. And we'll go and just different things that we'll do at the beginning, bands, cones, ladders, and I say soccer drills. Again, I'm not a huge soccer fan by any means, but I do think that you watch our guys, say it's a, you know, we'll do 10-yard distance and create a little bit of competition and have some fun where you bring a soccer ball out and you're like, hey, you got to zigzag through these cones or you got to go down and back. And the guys that can control the soccer ball, get it down, get it through all these cones are usually the guys that, I mean, feel the best for us. And part of the deal with the soccer ball is keeping their eyes up, right? Because we have to be able to move our feet and control our feet without looking down at them because we're not going to be very good defensively. We got a little Hawaiian kid who plays short for us that did a magician with the soccer ball, and he's probably our best defensive player. So it doesn't work across the board, but it's just fun, again, to see him and talk some trash as well, too, that way. When we talk about the bands, again, this is just a like short little better perform band that we'll put around our ankles for our guys. And they'll go in and out, whether it's a ladder, if there's a line on the ground, back and forth. The biggest thing that I like working with the bands is working drop step, especially for the corner guys. They're not very good in understanding, like, hey, just because people say attack the baseball, that doesn't mean I always have to be squared up to it running forward. Is that I can go on my diagonals there to create room to now make a long hop. This as well, with the bands, allows us to be explosive with our first step. And we'll take it off after we do a couple rounds so we can get the feeling of both of those. Cones, we'll do five cones, five different colors. And the reason I do the five different colors is just to make our guys think that we'll have the five different colors, and I'll maybe bark out a color, or our other position player will bark out a color, and sometimes we'll do it for time, sometimes we won't. It's just to do our pre-pitch hop, react, go touch that cone. The times that I want to do time, kind of my biggest thing on that is I want to find out where our guys are deficient and where our guys' strengths are, and say, hey, if he moves to the yellow cone, which is to our left over here, that's the quickest cone that he gets to, his forehand's probably his best attribute. So then when we think of the overall theme of how do I shift, well, maybe Bart's a heavy pull guy. We move him over to make it more of a forehand play for our shortstop or whoever it may be that's more of a forehand dominant player, rather than try to necessarily say, hey, well, we'll just keep on working at your backhand and get it just average. Well, let's keep your forehand really good and use that and try to make most plays with that. Ladders, pretty self-explanatory. Everybody, I'm sure, has their own ideas. We go with bands. Keeping the eyes up is key, and then being soft and quick with our feet. It's first baseman, third baseman, usually they try to go so fast through it that they just pound, pound, pound. And, we got new turf at Air Force, so hopefully, you know, we'll keep those guys from tearing it up too fast. So while that all is going on, we'll end up having, you know, four and four guys, and four guys are on vision. For baseball, the top three skills is visual acuity, visual information processing, and binocularity. Binocularity, I think, is huge, especially for catch play for the youth. So doing some of these hand-eye coordination, vision drills is key for them, I think, and what I've seen in being able to catch the ball. But if we just go down by the breakdown, visual acuity is just being able to recognize details with precision. When we talk about visual information processing, how does the brain process what we're seeing? Obviously, all of these are big coming to hitting, but I do think it's the same deal with infield as well, too. And then binocularity, are we seeing things and processing it with two eyes, or, you know, is one eye bad? I mean, my dad used to say that he would close one eye to try to hit, and he's like, I was a terrible baseball player. It's like, yeah, makes sense. So trying to understand, you know, does one of our guys, is one of our guys deficient in the right eye or left eye? So for all three of these, we try to focus, and that's what the drills that I have, for our guys that we do, and they're short, quick, and we don't do all of them obviously every day, but we'll change it up from day to day. But just to throw them all out there for you guys, but 4 to 5 times a week, again, 5 minutes. It's great for low budget. I mean, if you look at everything that we had on the list, I think that the one thing that we have that's great that our guys really do enjoy is the strobe glasses, and those are like $199. But everything else is $799 or less. So pretty easy. I mean, we have numbered tennis ball grab, two ball drop, the Marston ball, which is just a cool name for a ball on a string. And then colored ball short hops. We got the Brock string, and then we got near and far peripheral charts, and then do juggling as well, too, whether that's off a wall or whether that's just with the three balls in the hand here. Just kind of going down and explain each one quickly. We talked about the number tennis ball grab. So we'll do up to five balls with that, but just kind of to show you, like I have a 2 here and a 3 here. And if I'm with a partner, we'll just drop them straight to the ground and say what ball the person tries to grab. It'll start out maybe above the head and drop. And as our guys get better, we'll start lowering the hand down so they have less time to try to react and grab it. The whole goal is to try to grab the number that is called out before the ball hits the ground. Sometimes we'll do it on a bounce. For me, you know, 5 balls is probably the top. I mean, 4 is good. Some of our guys they're way smarter than me. Like, take me 3 times to score what they scored on the ACT. So they'll probably do like square root and times tables and things like that. But addition and subtraction is another way to say, hey, you know, 5, what 2 balls are you going to grab, the 2 and the 3. So just different things, variables that you can add in there where our guys have to think and think quick to make a decision. 2 ball drop. Again, we'll sit here. Doesn't have to be with the numbers, but I'll be with the partner and I'll tell them maybe, hey, stare at this ball here. They'll stare at that the whole time. I'll move it around and then I'll drop this ball and they want to try to grab it before it hits the ground. So again, they're focused on an event over here, and then they got to use their peripherals to catch a ball over here. Let's Marston ball on a string. I'll actually use a different ball here. But again, as you can see here, okay, so we got B, E, 4, A. Again, as easy as string comes out of top, usually sticks to the top of the wall, and we'll just work on trying to keep rhythm, hitting maybe a certain letter or even just a plain baseball, just trying to hit it and keep rhythm. One thing we've added with that, and this is a free app on Apple, is a metronome. So it just does a synced up buzz or bang, whatever, you know, some type of noise to try to keep our guys on rhythm. And it's actually very difficult to get the hang of it. Like, guys want to hit it really hard, they're like super soft. And so just again, trying to square up a baseball with that hand-eye coordination and keep it on rhythm there, is something that we add to it. You can do it off, you can do it with 2 hands, you can do it with 1 hand, you can do it on 1 foot, 2 feet, whatever it may be, just add some difference to it. Colored ball, short hop, again, something as easy as an orange lacrosse ball, white lacrosse ball, throw it off the wall from behind them. Left hand catches the white one, right hand catches the orange one, or a orange one you got to catch on the second bounce. Just different things where, again, we have to process it and try to move our feet and be in a good position. Strobe glasses, pretty self-explanatory. Brock string, working on binocularity, where we're trying to create the X's in each one of the colored beads that's on the line, letting our 2 eyes work together. And then last, near far peripheral charts. So we'll have 2 charts here and here. They're supposed to look straight ahead, just move the eyes, go back and forth. And then we'll have 1 close and 1 far away, working near far. And we'll go 15 seconds on, 15 seconds off, and compete against each other, and then we'll keep track of it. So if it ends up, my contact information should be on the breakdown of what I'm talking about today and reach out, I can send those over to you for free, something easy, and I just put them on a shoebox up there for our guys so they can do it in the indoor while they're waiting around to hit. So once we go from the vision side of things, go to the focus of the day, we'll have a mechanical focus, and then we'll also have a game day focus. Mechanical focus is more of just slowed down, making sure that our guys are doing the proper things. And we always say we're not going to move on with our mechanical focus until we've mastered what we're doing that day, because this is all pretty much mental that they can focus on. So some drill examples that we have, I just put like six of them down where we say our prep step, our glove thumb, 10 or 11 o'clock, glove pat rhythm, two-step, four-step, our three-bag double play, and then glove hand fielding progression that we'll have with our guys. We can do some pick tags with three different zones that we'll work with our guys, understanding where they're trying to work, whether it's forehand, backhand, whether they need to go out and get it, whether they play back on the bag and take it. But the prep step is where we start out with. Again, we can do dry reps there, making sure that we're balanced. We're focused on our angles. Is that most people, I just think about our shortstop, and then our shortstop has his left shoulder turned more toward the hitter, so it cuts off our angle to our forehand here. So making sure that our shoulders are squared up toward the dugout so we can create that good movement, good angle each direction. So we'll start out with that. I said, I think for those, I mean, it's the best to go underhand rolls for our guys, is that allows them to master it. As soon as you put a machine out there, it's about fielding the baseball, especially for the younger guys that I've noticed. It's okay, we bring a machine out, that's like the coolest thing ever, and allows us to get more reps, but we don't focus on the aspects of, hey, I'm supposed to go my two-step pattern or my four-step pattern, or my fingers are straight down like this instead of relaxed at 10 or 11 with my glove hand to be able to be relaxed as I'm fielding. Then we move into, I guess I would say, more of our game day focus. And some examples of our game day focus are top spin balls, backspin balls, velocity, being in shifting positions when we're making plays, forehand, backhand, the different footwork on that, and then talking about our different lanes, whether it's a one-hand lane or a two-hand lane. When I talk about two-hand lane, that's, for me, it's going to make sure that we're fielding from the mid center of our body over to my left foot. Our one-hand lane is going to be anything outside of my feet, so my forehand outside of my middle lane, and then backhands outside of my right foot as well, too, which we can go into more detail if anybody has questions. But those two things will be after our footwork and our vision, and then we'll jump into our practice variability for full defense. This is, I think, probably my favorite part of practice, because it puts our guys in a little bit of different spin on things, and it challenges them a little bit more. There's no way that you can maybe put the pressure of a game, but I try to create that as much as possible, or different drills from other people that I've learned along the way to try to add on there. For this, I want our guys just to go out and play and be athletes. We'll use a machine every single time for this, just because it allows for better accuracy, more reps in this way. I love hitting a fungo just as much as any other person, but I wasn't always the best with accuracy. So allow us to get through everything faster. We'll use the machines. So Hack Attack Junior, and there's A-Tech, the M3X. The Hack Attack Juniors are great for us because we can go short or long distance there with that. So kind of the two things that I think about first when we go into the variability is stopwatch. It'd be great if we just had like 10 people that could run the bases all the time, but we don't. So the stopwatch is going to be key for us, allow us to play either above speed or as close to speed as possible. So we'll see how quickly guys can make plays, but also you have a guy that's a 4-4 down the line, understanding like if we have a little bit of a bobble, we still might have a chance if we take our time to make a good throw. So understanding that side of things, also tell them, hey, if we're trying to go as quick as we can, maybe our throw is going to be at our belly button instead of throwing it through our chin. Because if I go at the belly button, my first baseman has to reach out and cuts down the distance there, as opposed to saying more of a 4-6, 4-7 runner, I can just throw it straight through the chin and I don't have to worry about anything. The stopwatch, I do think the negatives of it are is that we don't see those runners. I think there's a lot of cues that we take as infielders, picking up the ball, fielding it. The first thing I'm going to see is, where is that runner coming down the line, right? If he's halfway down, I know that I have a little bit more time. If he's past halfway, shoot, I got to get rid of it a little bit faster. So the stopwatch does help us out to speed the game up, but I also think there are some negatives and would love to have just a base runner if possible. Turf field, we have a turf field, like I said, creates laziness, to be honest with you. So we have a softball field and a JV field. It's probably one of the worst fields in America, but it is, it's fun to take our guys out there and see who complains about it. From the softball field side of things, we'll hit from the outfield, hit off the grass to go onto the dirt just to give them a different look. When we have been on turf for a while, I'll make sure that when we go to a natural surface, we're fielding with one hand because it allows our guys to reach out in front and really extend through and keep their eyes on the baseball. Whereas if we play with two hands, a lot of times we're funneling back into our body. When it's on turf, we don't follow it all the way through. As we go into the drills, I got a few drills here that some of my favorites are 3-plate D, 4-3-2-1 phases, and 8-ball pregame IO, and then live reps. 3-plate D for you guys is just like 3-plate if you would have the machine, where it speeds up the game. If you go to your initial position, you'll go up 10 feet and then back 10 feet. So if we move up 10 feet at your normal position, obviously you're going to get more hot shots, have to work on some diving plays, have a little more time that way. Then we go back 10 feet where we really have to use our legs to be able to make the throw across. We will adjust times with the stopwatch in that to try to see, make it more realistic. But our guys, if they feel comfortable throwing 10 feet behind their regular position, working on their arm that way, then when they move up to normal positioning, it's going to be pretty easy. 4-3-2-1.
1 minute warning, Jimmy.
Yeah, gotcha. 4-3-2-1. We got everybody. We'll have two different teams. Everybody will go out to short. And even our first baseman will go there. So the one team will be at short. The other four guys will be at a different base. And we'll shoot it out of the machine and I'll call out a number. 1, 2, 3, or 4 correlates to first base, second base, third base, and home. So they don't know where they're going. So they have to redirect and make a good throw at each position. We can make a different, whether it's a double play feed to second base or across the first. Arm fake and throw to third, all those different things. You can also add in the team that's receiving, have them do a cut relay or a double play, act like they're getting a double play, just everything in that nature. Kind of the last two things, 8-ball and live reps, 8-ball pregame IO. The biggest thing for me is that for our guys is that I want them to have feel some pressure if they throw a ball away. If we get finished with the 8 balls, then they're done. Obviously, we'll go up to all the way to 4 balls. So put a little more pressure on them that way. And then lastly, live reps. No ball to the outfield is our kind of mentality. And we want to do dry reps with our prep step where we hop and be explosive with our 3 steps, even if it's a fly ball to right field and I'm standing at shortstop. So we're working on taking the proper footwork. Just kind of some information there, data evaluation, didn't get to it, but you have my contact information. I'd love to talk more about it. And if you have questions, when we get to the question and answer, let's do it. So thanks, Bart.
Jimmy, thank you so much, man. You were concerned about filling that much time, but you crushed it. It was perfect.
Appreciate it.
Good job. All right. Jim will be back in the Q&A again. If you have any questions, feel free to put those in the Q&A so we can get them asked. Don't put them in the chat. Put them in the Q&A feature. And then we're going to go on to our last actual presenter for the day, certainly not least, Chris Cook, the head coach at New Mexico Military Institute, which is a plays in the NJCAA Junior College Baseball, two-year school. However, they probably have the hardest recruiting job in the country compared to everybody else there at NIMI. And I will tell you this. When Chris says in the outline, reach out to him for additional charts and additional information, do it. I had the pleasure of seeing him present at the ABC Barnstormers Clinic in New Mexico a couple years ago and just absolutely crushed it and had a plethora of information available for guys to use that easy to plug and play. So looking forward to what he has for us here. Chris Cook from NIMI, the floor is yours, my friend. And feel free to take your entire time. We're about 5 minutes behind schedule. Take your full 20, and then we'll get into Q&A, all right?
Sounds good. Thank you, Andrew. Can you hear me okay?
Just fine.
Okay. Well, I appreciate the opportunity to speak. And other coaches, nice job. Coach Madsen, thank you for your service. Obviously, we're getting close to the fourth weekend, and can't thank all of the current and former military members enough for everything they've sacrificed for this country and for us individually. I'm going to skip through my bio too much because I got several things I want to cover. New Mexico Military is a junior college. We are affiliated with. We aren't necessarily an academy, although I have players every year that are working to prep into the military academies across the country. We have ROTC and things like that, but our guys do follow Army regulations, and our school is kind of modeled after West Point or VMI. I'll continue on with what I was going to talk about. First things first, I'm going to try to share a screen here with a packet of information. I've got a PDF. I'm going to quickly go through what we do for practice plans. I've got two examples. One is a early spring practice plan. The other, the next page that I'll show is an early fall. Really, the only thing I want to mention on this is that we just try to keep a set routine. I like routines. I mean, baseball is really great for routines. I know that some of this stuff doesn't translate to possibly Little League or even high school with all the different differences that are around, mainly the pitching side of things. At the lower levels, it's hard to find a true PO. Most of your pitchers are your best position players. And so that creates a big wrinkle that high school coaches and youth coaches have to battle. But just as an example, I wanted to show kind of how we set this up. And I like it because my guys know, they know where to look, they know what to expect when they show up to practice, from what to wear to when they need to arrive if there's early work. I personally like pre-practice meetings, and I'll get into that here in a second, but I'm gonna scroll down quickly again, because I got more important stuff to cover. Through a couple different practice plans from different periods of time. So we basically will go early work, individual defense, some type of team fundamental, into a BP segment of some sort. I'll get into that more in a minute. And then we finish with our field duties. And back to the BP. Some days I'll do a regular BP, just typical batting practice. And we finish with that because typically that's going to have the most focus from your players, because they're always excited to hit. But there are some days, and more so over the past, I'd say the past 1 to 2 years, I've kind of gone away from as much regular batting practice. Your old school, pitchers are going to shag, the hitters are going to be in four groups, they're going to rotate through and hit their 15 to 20 cuts. I've gone away from that quite a bit over the last 2 years, more into team specific batting practice rotations, or more simulated live batting practice. So you can see on this practice plan, we did some team fundamentals first. We banged them out. You're talking 10 to 15, maybe 20 minutes a segment. Because like the other academies, we aren't blessed with 4 to 6 hours of practice time a day. We've got limited time. So we're hammering out stuff in quick intervals. And then at the end of practice, we'll do something, whether it's batting practice or a live segment. Let me move on to why I like team meetings. Now, most coaches are kind of control freaks. I get that. I personally like team meetings because it signifies the start of practice. And I'm not talking about a 10, 15 minute meeting. I'm talking, all right, my guys know at 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, whatever it is, we're going to meet in the dugout. We're going to go through some quick stuff on what practice is about, what the plan is, and then they're going to start their dynamic warm-up. And it could literally be 30 seconds long. It could be 5 minutes long. But I started to go away from having pre-practice meetings because it can feel like a waste of time. But I like it because it signifies to the players, they know what's about to happen next. There is no lag getting into dynamic warm-up. There is no lag getting into your throwing. It lets them know kind of what's going on. And it also lets me know, I may have a guy that ends up stuck in the training room or is sick that I wasn't aware of, or somebody has a study group. And that gives me an extra 10 or 15 minutes, maybe 20 minutes to readjust some practice stuff going on. If I'm missing my only available first baseman that day, then I better adjust the practice plan if we need to use if he was going to be involved significantly in the practice. So it signals the start of practice. It's a routine. To me, it's very important. All right, so I'm going to move on to our warm-up. Dynamic warm-ups are, everybody's kind of got their way of doing things. What I like to do is, if I'm going to do something, I want it to incorporate more than one aspect of the game. So what we decided to do is create a base running warm-up where our guys will split into four groups. And one of those four groups will go to first, the other one to second, to third, and to home plate. And we'll do our normal, you know, active warm-up from the guys at home plate. We'll do their, you know, their karaoke from home to first. And they might switch sides halfway to first base. And then the guys going from first to second will do some type of a lunge and maybe a knee tuck. What we'll do is they'll do their normal everyday dynamic warm-up, but they're doing it on the base paths because we have a turf infield. It's not going to hurt anything. And what we started incorporating after we got through the basic dynamic stuff that a lot of people do is then we started doing actual baseball, base running specific drills with a coach on the mound, throwing BP balls to home plate. We'll usually set up one of those mini L screens at home plate, and we start off throwing a combination of either dirt balls or balls that hit into the L screen about catcher high. And I won't get into specifics on how we do all that, but the reason we did it is to try to incorporate a way for guys to focus on their base running stuff while they're getting loose. It's not full speed. That's the only negative, in my opinion, is these guys aren't 100% loose yet, but they should be ready to go focus-wise, and we can hammer out whatever we decide we want to focus on that day. If you're looking at this screen here, I'm going to try to annotate a little bit. We probably get through about this much on a normal dynamic warm-up. And it's just hard to go unless you've got an extra 10 minutes, which a lot of places don't have. It's hard to get through all of this stuff. So the beauty of something like this, you can set it up to your own terminology. You can set this up to your own techniques, what you feel is important, what you think your deficiencies are, but you can cover almost any type of base running in a dynamic warm-up. Again, the drawback here is that they're not 100% loose. They're not ready to go full speed yet. Anyway, I wanted to share this. Now, do we do this every day? No, because the reality is if we're going to play in a tournament or we're going to play Odessa College, I'm not going to take over their whole infield when we're doing warm-ups during their batting practice. It's just impossible. So we're going to practice this on a, you know, it may be Mondays and Wednesdays. We do a regular dynamic warm-up in the outfield, just like we would do if we showed up to your field to play a fall scrimmage or a spring regular season game. And then on the other days of the week, we may incorporate this with a coach on the mound. I never like showing up for a game doing something that we haven't practiced on the field. And that includes dynamic warm-up. That includes the national anthem. That includes how we react after a walk-off win, whether we're on defense or whether we're on offense. We practice all of that stuff ahead of time to try to make sure guys are, you know, they've been there before, they've done that. They understand what's going on. Nothing's new. Okay, so I'm going to quickly move through this. Let me clear those marks for you guys. Let's see what this next page is. Next one we're going to get into is the throwing. Coach just brought up some of this stuff. This was kind of a compilation of different coaches and different resources, something that we put together while I was at Arkansas State years ago. It's called Championship Catch. This is not an everyday throwing program because you're not going to get the long toss most of your players want. We use this, especially in the fall, when we're trying to emphasize how important just playing catch is. As Coach mentioned, we did some research at Arkansas State within our own program. We measured every type of defensive mistake, whether it was a bobble, a throw, whether it was a catch. We tallied all that for an entire fall, and the information we got was basically kind of counterintuitive. We realized that most of the errors were throwing and catching, because in my opinion, a big hop ground ball that pounces out of your glove, that's not a fielding error. In my opinion, that's a catching error. That ball is at your chest. That ball should be caught. And so it kind of opened our eyes, and it was the start of us incorporating this championship catch at the D1 level. And then I've incorporated it here at New Mexico Military. What I like about it is it changes the mindset when players are getting ready to get their arms loose. And so if I scroll down here to about day 4, and again, this is so versatile. You can change all of these throwing drills. You can change the distances, the minutes. It's all versatile to how you like to teach, you know, throwing mechanics. Some of these throwing mechanics I don't even like anymore. This thing's more than 10 years old now. So I've already changed some of this stuff within our program. But what this does is it gets the guys at a short distance, they're just getting loose. But as a coach, you're counting every time a baseball hits the ground, I make a little tally mark. And I decide for the day what the penalty might be. And I don't like a lot of negatives. I don't like a lot of penalties. But the reality is, in the game of baseball, every time you make a mistake, it hurts. Like, there's something's going to happen. Somebody's going to have to step up to overcome that mistake. And so we try to do this as positively as we can, but there's always some type of a consequence for a drop. And so we start out short. We're working different throwing drills. And then as they get past about 60 feet, they start using position-specific drills. And so the infielders, for instance, every time they catch a baseball, they're going to reset themselves into a fielding position of their choice, and they're going to make the next throw back to their partner from that fielding position. Once they get to 90 feet, then it becomes throwing from a fielding position, but also receiving in some type of a specific technique. So it could be every time I receive a ball, I'm going to simulate a relay throw. Every time I catch a ball, I'm going to simulate a catch tag at a base, or I'm going to simulate a double play feed coming to me as a shortstop or the second baseman. And so it really ups the focus, the footwork. And again, you're dealing with drops and different things like that. And what I'll mention on this is the big lecture prior to starting this is about what we call non-errors. And I think everybody has an understanding probably of what some of those non-errors are, but non-errors to me are huge. Those are the those are the, you know, relay throw from center field to third base, and the relay guy bobbles it, and then the throw to third is just a hair late. Nobody gets an error on that, but there was definitely an opportunity missed because of the baseball was not handled. Same thing on a double play. You know, baseball rules dictate the if you throw the ball away at, from second base after getting the first force out, if you throw the ball away or mishandle that ball and no one advances past first, then there's no error on the play. Well, we all know that there was an out to be made that did not happen. So we talk about non-errors because the physical stuff happens. But championship catch was a way for us to really emphasize the defensive things we wanted to get and get them out of the normal routine of just lobbing the baseball around and, you know, throwing was just something you got to get through before you go hit. And that's the mindset of a lot of kids, and not just young kids, but even college kids. And then what we do long toss wise is we'll usually, if we need them to stretch it out that day, because we're going to throw full length throws, then we'll give them unstructured time after the championship catch is over so that they can get their arms loose as needed. Other than championship catch, our long tosses, there's nothing crazy about it. We use the Jaeger long toss program. We let them air it out and we try to give them as much time as we can. Some guys want to throw for 30 minutes. It's probably impossible most practice sessions for that to happen, but we try to let the guys have some freedom in listening to what their arms are needing on a given day and to try to get them ready to throw. And then at the end of the championship catch, we may incorporate, like it says down here, let me see if I can highlight that for you. But this day, for instance, we might do a rocket relay drill where everybody's lined up and we've got maybe five groups of four working on rocket relay competitions. That might be how we finish up the day for this throwing, or we may break them into groups and work on some of our rundown techniques where we're having to handle the baseball. And the interesting story on this, the first time we ever did this, I'm sitting there explaining this to my guys, and I said, okay, you guys are on the clock. They're all gathered around me. I got the ball basket sitting next to me. I hit the stopwatch. The first guy to grab a ball out of the glove, one of our first basemans from Memphis, he grabs the ball out of the bucket, and as he's putting it into his first baseman's mitt, it hits the ground, and you know, I say, there's one, and the look on his face was priceless, and he was like, how can you count that? We haven't started yet. I said, and this was before I ever knew about Mexico military. I said, Brandon, if that was a hand grenade, would you have dropped it? And he said, no, sir. I said, well, that's the mindset that I want you to have through this championship catch. So anyways, moving on. After throwing, we typically will do our individual defense there. I'm not going to get into that too much, but we used the NDD at that time because their arms should be nice and loose. Let me stop this annotation real quick so I can scroll down. Okay, so after the NDD is where we would do our team fundamentals. I'm going to share one of these fundamentals here. Now, I'm not the smartest dude in the world. I'm not going to try to take credit for any of this stuff. This was a modified version of something I picked up again at Arkansas State from one of our pitching coaches who worked at University of Washington. They had a whole packet full of fundies, fundy one, fundy two. This is what I call team fundamental one. And the reason I like it is it incorporates all positions all at once. It only takes two fungo hitters, and it's huge on communication, which I'm really big on. So we're going to work communication with the entire team using Fundy 1 in two groups. On the left side of the infield, this is where it's a little bit complicated, but it's really just a matter of making sure you communicate to your players ahead of time. This is how the drill's set up. This is what your mindset is, your focus is, and once you get it going, you shouldn't have any issues. The one weird thing about this, okay, the fungo hitter here on at home plate that is hitting the ball to the left side through the six hole, from an outfielder's perspective, they are looking at this play as though there's a runner at second base. So as the ball gets through the infield, they are going to be using whatever your program's throwing rules are to make decisions on where they are throwing the ball. In our program, if they bobble the baseball or they take more than seven steps or and so on, that ball is going to automatically be redirected back to second base. But if it's a normal, clean catch in the outfield and their movement is heading towards the lead base, they're going to make a lead base throw to the catcher. The beauty of this is that the third baseman's also trying to field this ball just like he would in a game. And now he's got to really bust his butt to get deep enough to be in cut position or relay position. And one of the things that we really have to harp on with our freshmen and sophomores that we deal with is getting them to get deep enough when they are making relay throws. Because my goal is that no relay throw gets over anybody's head, because the batter runner, that's what they're looking for. So if my third baseman dies for this ball, he's got a long ways to go to get himself into cut position with the catcher. Shortstop then is doing what they do. They're going to be heading from there. They're going to be trying to get this ground ball through the six hole. And if they miss it or it gets past them, then they got to swap out with the third baseman as normal. So that's the play from an outfielder's perspective. The runners at second base, they're throwing to a lead base. If there's a bobble or another issue, then that ball is going to be redirected straight to the second baseman. Okay. All right. Now let me clear those lines, because the infielders have a much different perspective on this. From an infielder's perspective, this ball's hit into the six hole. There's a runner on first base only. If the ball stays on the infield, in their heads, the runner is only at first. So this is the type of ball that if the shortstop fields, there is no chance of us turning two. So he's probably going to have to make an off-balance throw to the second baseman. The second baseman's probably going to have to stretch like a first baseman to get that force out. Okay, same thing sort of with the third baseman. He may be coming over to get a slow roller, or he may dive to get a ball. The second baseman's got to use that internal clock he's got in his head to determine, am I going to be faking a throw to first like I'm turning two, or am I going to be stepping off the base so that I don't get spiked on a really close or a bang-bang play at second? Okay, so there's a little bit of a different mindset for the outfielders versus the infielders. What does happen here, this is the one part that can get a little hairy if you've got pitchers that are space-headed. Whenever the second baseman does get a baseball, whether it's from the shortstop, the third baseman, or the outfielder, he's then going to redirect the ball quickly on a one hop, hopefully a long hop. We're not trying to kill anybody, but he's going to try to throw a long hop to the catcher. The catcher then is working on his sweep tags at home plate. So it basically involves everybody all the time on the left side of the infield. All right, quickly as I can on the right side, you can see that with this, we use our batting turtle, the batting cage, the portable batting cage, to protect our fungo hitter on the first base side so that a throw from the outfield doesn't hit him in the head. We move our pitchers over slightly, and I usually place a first base bag over here on our turf so that we get accurate distances for these other right side infielders. And all we're doing here is working on our standard PFP plays. Whatever your program uses for communication, we're working through those with fungos to, you know, second, fungos to first, or fungos down in here for the pitchers and first baseman to communicate. It's real pretty simple. If you happen to have a bunch of guys on your program, we don't normally break out this extra home plate and an extra first baseman. But if you've got too many catchers, for instance, then you can throw a plate over here and a first baseman over here, and they're pretty safe to be running any type of block, you know, drop third strike or a ball in the dirt drill or back pick to first base. There's lots of options there. And again, I know I got limited time, so I'll just – one last thing on this drill is because they're making full-length throws in the outfield, it's a good idea not to do this for more than about 10 or 15 minutes most likely. All right, let me move out of this one.
About okay. One more minute, Skip, and then we'll go to some Q&A, okay?
How much? I'm sorry.
One or two minutes.
Okay. All right, cool. All right, BP, like I was saying earlier, I've kind of gotten away from your typical batting practice. Now, here's something I think can work at all levels. When you're doing BP, one of the things that we all kind of get frustrated with is, what do I do with all the people that are sitting around that batting cage? Or and so what we started doing is, you got your hitter in the batting cage. Okay. He is right. Let me annotate. He is right here. Okay. He's taking his, whatever your batting rounds are of the day. As soon as his hitting group is over, he's going to head out to the visiting side of the field, and he's going to pretend he's in the first base dugout. He's on deck. He's going to get his timing right there. When that next hitter is done, he's going to rotate to the middle where Barry is at, right-handed Barry. And he's going to stand straight behind, using whatever your vision technique, whatever you preach for vision, he's going to sit right back there, and he's purely focused on watching the ball out of that pitcher's hand and working on his mental hitting stuff. From there, he's going to go to the, for us, the home side of the field. He's right back into the on-deck circle. He's doing the exact same thing he would do in a game, mentally going through his routine. He's working timing with the BP pitcher. And then the only spot on this that isn't really game-like is this number five guy. He's basically here because we all have limited time in batting practice. He can still work some timing, this and that, but he's got to stay out of the way of any fungo hitters. But he's basically there because you just don't have 40 seconds to wait for a guy to walk all the way up to get into batting practice. So I wanted to touch on that. I know I'm out of time. I've got a ton of different charts, different things that you might be able to incorporate into practice to make things a little bit more exciting, more fun. Wish I had time to go through all those, but I would be happy to email you PDFs, Excel spreadsheets, or anything like that. Thank you, Coach, for letting me speak.
Coach Cook, thank you so much for joining us, man. And I can't stress it enough. The man has an extremely organized library of outstanding resources that he has created. So please feel free to reach out to Chris Cook. He'll get you set up with a lot of really good info. All right. Let's get into Q&A. And perfect, Coach. Thanks for popping off of there. Jimmy, I forgot to give you instructions not to answer a bunch of the questions by typing the answer. So that's on me. I'm going to be accountable. Right, Coach Madsen? I'm going to be accountable and say that I should have told him not to do that. So there's some accountability there. I think I've got time for about one question each. So Coach Madsen, right-handed pitcher on the mound, what body part do you have your base runners key in order to get a good jump of on straight field? So a lot of guys look at the back knees, some guys look at the hands, some look at the head. What do you have them key in on when you're trying to steal second base?
I used to be a front side guy. I see front side because I thought all that moved first. And then after spending some time talking to JB at Clemson and really looking at some other things, I start head down. Find the head. He brought it up, and then I studied and looked at it and looked at it and looked at it. Before anything goes, the head starts. The head either will give you a cue to start your shuffle, or they'll come still, or they'll take a deep breath, or they'll do something with their head. And a lot of times they will really laser focus in before they go home. And the first thing that happens is that hat goes up, right? They start going that way. And the head goes up before the leg goes. So I find the head will give you a sense of direction first. So I start head down. So, and then starting at the head, working down, you can start seeing cues and pick up on other tells and stuff too. I always start at the head.
Gotcha. I'll say this, Jimmy, when it comes to JB, Jared Broughton, who was a guest on USA Baseball Virtual Coaches Clinic, I don't remember what number, a few weeks ago, did a great job. Indianapolis guy, or Indianapolis area guy, I coached against him when he played at Vincennes. So I'll drop even more, Southeastern Illinois.
Yeah, nice.
And that stuff on you. So.
Nice.
Coach Roesinger, are there higher level drills you now teach at the Little League level because you came to the realization those drills address the skills that should actually be taught at a much earlier age? It's a very good question, Rich Moretta. Tip of the cap that I don't have on to you today.
Yeah, I mean, I guess there are higher level drills that I will teach with them. I think more of the higher level stuff that we will do with them will be more machine based. And so it'll turn up the speed on the machine just because when you first start out with the kids, it's maybe like a roll of the ball. But as soon as you insert a machine, then everything goes out the window. So that's something that we've added in, had the ability to do that with a machine. Another way that we've added into it, if you don't have the ability for a machine, is add in two or three different balls. So a baseball, a lacrosse ball, a softball, and create different timing aspects that way, or variables that way. And then adding just multiple different scenarios. If a shortstop's thrown over to the first baseman, the first baseman receives it and has to do a relay throw to second base. So there are not all, as Coach Kaz would say, there's no breadlines of people just standing around. It's always keeping people moving.
Nice. Like the 15th time I've heard the crossballs referenced between the catching guys and the infield guys. You know, it's a great teaching tool, great inexpensive teaching tool. Awesome. Coach Cook, let me ask you this. Let's shift gears a little bit, and let's say you have a youth practice and you've got your guys for 2 hours, one time a week. Give me like a couple of the most important things that you would want to get accomplished in those 2 hours.
I'll be honest. Until my daughter started playing youth softball, I would be the worst person in the world to ask, because that is such another level. I mean, that is true coaching, in my opinion. From watching some youth softball, what I think I would incorporate is, like, if a kid can't play catch, that's going to be hard to advance. If a kid doesn't have fun, it's going to be very hard for them to advance. And for me, it's about I see a lot of teams, especially little leagues, focusing a lot on winning the games, and that's a whole nother hot topic. But I see kids and coaches worried about winning when they don't know what a force out is. They don't understand how to take a turn around a base. They don't understand, all sorts of different aspects of the game. So I would think throwing, learn how to throw hard. I mean, throw the ball hard, but try to also learn accuracy. It's really just the basics. I think sometimes we try to overcomplicate stuff, but playing catch, like, that doesn't go away. My guys have to learn how to play catch. I mean, and that's every level of college that I've been at. So catch, and then trying to take away, if it were me, I try to take away fear from these kids. Like, they're so worried about swinging and missing. They're so worried about making a mistake. I think that's, in short, I think those are the things I'd focus on.
Awesome. You touched on that about the true coaching, and I got a glimpse of it this spring before we got shut down coaching my daughter's 4 and 5 year old T-ball team. And we went out, the entire first practice was me walking them to each spot on the field and showing them what the positions are. You know what I mean? It's go out, come back, go out, come back. It's like the wagon wheel, you know, the wagon wheel teaching method, but it's like, we're all going here, we're all going there. Then we're going to switch up and I'm going to tell you, go to left field. And it was like, what's left field, you know? So that was through coaching. I did throw in the chat, I threw a link before you jump off here. Check it out. MLB Hit and Run. It's a program with USA Baseball, MLB. Hit and Run, it's all about game modifications. I'm on the committee. There's a people a lot smarter and a lot better than me on the committee as well. We're coming up with game modifications, practice modifications to make the game a little more exciting, maybe help some leagues out. It's actually going to be utilized a lot more, I think, in the post-COVID-19 era. We have an even more info coming out on that. So while we're talking about, you know, what youth baseball looks like, it might look a little bit different, but it's going to contribute to the growth of the game, similar to how 3-on-3 basketball and 7-on-7 football contribute to the growth of those sports. We can do the same thing baseball-wise. All right, well, let's one more question here, just because we got to get it in. Tanner Vesey wants to know, Coach Madsen, can you discuss the Nana play some more and what that might look like?
My Necton brother. Nana, so, oh, God, let's see. I got to tell us the right way. Nana was a play, essentially a play. We had one on offense. We had one on defense. That was it just created excitement. And from full disclosure, one of our players had a grandmother that didn't look like a grandmother. Let's just say that, right? She was, I think she was like 71. And
just watch it cut off the Facebook live stream right now. Is this a good time?
No, we're good. I'm done with that. But essentially was excited, like a play. I think, I don't know, other coaches call it a different thing, but if you have a guy on second and there's a wild pitch on a walk, right? The guy goes to third, the batter's going to first. We may yell Nana, and that batter will keep going to see if the catcher hustles back to the fence. And then we'll just create excitement and chaos, right? So that was chaos. And then we have one on defense also. So that's about it. That's, you know, Nana.
There's some different things that come up during the course of yes.
Thank you, Tanner.
Right. All right, let's conclude USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 16. Coach Madsen, again, thank you for your service. Thanks for being with us. Coach Roesinger, thank you for what you do with the future leaders of our country. Coach Cook, thank you for what you do with the future leaders of our country. You guys are appreciated, and thank you so much for carving the time away from families, away from work, to be with us today and to share with us. We appreciate you, and thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity. Appreciate it, Bart.
Reminder, I put some links in the chat. Go to usabdevelops.com, download the USA Baseball Mobile Coach app. It's free. Jump on our certification pathway, get USA Baseball certified. It is free, levels A, B, and C. You've already been to a coach's clinic. That is required for level C. Check out game modifications on MLB, USA Baseball Hit and Run. And finally, starting now, for the next 24 hours, go to usabaseballshop.com. Get 20% off of your entire purchase using the code CLINIC16, CLINIC16. Check out the new USA Baseball gear that we have in. I believe baseballism face shields are coming in this week also to the USA Baseball Shop, so check those out. And we'll be back here next Wednesday from 12 to 3 Eastern time. Just confirmed two really, really good speakers while this clinic was going on via text. So I jumped out a couple times, guys getting back to me. So it'll be a really good event like this one was. 48 hours after this is over, you can check this clinic out on YouTube. Go to youtube.com/USA Baseball TV. You can also view any of the previous 15 coaches' clinics over the holiday or if you're not working tomorrow. Thank you to those who protect our freedom, and we're blessed to be here in this country. And I'm blessed to be a part of USA Baseball. I appreciate putting their colors on every day. Thank you so much, and we will see you next Wednesday.